that's so exciting and it's so amazingly attractive.
Yeah, you're not laughing now, are you?
What? One second.
That is our fine. Look, if I didn't do that, I'm not going to go into why I had to clean my teeth so urgently. Lovely to see you here. 22H, long time no see. I don't even know. I can't remember the name, but I know the picture. Is that the Dogecoin dog? Is that Doge? It is a brushing stream, yeah. No, we're going to enjoy tonight's stream. Let's get some hellos in before the riffraff turn up. But we have got plenty of OG scrubs in, which is absolutely lovely. Entropy, the grift is on, people. You've got Entropy up there, Super Chats down there. You can use this. If you put your phone camera over that, it'll give you a link. It's Buy Me a Beer. You know that one? If you want. I've had a couple of people use it. Thank you, JC, and thank you, Brad, for donating via that revenue stream. I'm up with it all. Baz, hello Baz. He's talking about religious turncoats, and let's see what the unhinged religious turncoat and degenerate pimp says. Who's that, them or me? You know what, Baz, I sent the clip we're going to look at. I've already seen it, and I want to thank Duckboy Jaiden, because he sent it to me, and he know I have voiced, right? Just stop shouting, Chris. The microphone works. You'll be told if it doesn't. I'm now going to be told it doesn't because people like to wind me up. I sent it to Mark Collette. I said, I'd be interested to know what you think about this. And he got back to me almost immediately. And that's relevant. I'm not just saying, no, he got back to me immediately because I'm important. But he got back to me. He said, I'll have a look. Nice one. Hope you're well. All that. Nice. And he said, but I'm going to have a struggle out of a couple of blokes who've made their money. Now, I'm paraphrasing. I only heard the message once, but so that I don't put words in his mouth, what I'll say is essentially the characters, I can't even remember his name, hang on, Andrew Tate and Tristan Tate, his brother, who I think I like more. You know, they've made their money out of young, broken coomers who sit there going, nah, and also getting people to invest money into get-rich-quick schemes and all, you know, and other blags. Now, is that a bad thing? Is that a good thing? We're all fighting for resources. Okay, but what I've said negative things about Andrew Tate on here because I haven't taken to him in the past. You know, I don't think he thinks about what he's saying. I think he's thought about what he's saying. And, you know, many different interviews, many situations, the same stuff. But I thought, hang on, okay. But he's got a huge audience. He's got a huge influence. There's no doubt in that. You know, the evidence is there. It's not as big as he thinks, but it's pretty big. You can check all this out for yourself. Go to Google Trends. There's other sort of SEMrush, other sorts of software out there. If you really want to know that sort of stuff, ping me an email. I'll give you 20 years of marketing for, I don't know, 40 quid. you can do that now, and I'll you know. I've just done my Andrew Tate marketing. You only really need one bit of software and you'll learn so much about how the internet works. Anyway, slowly I've been coming round a bit to his persona. Now, yeah, how do I see, you know, as someone who has certainly indulged in ladies of the night myself, who am I to judge a man who's made his money facilitating that kind of stuff? Selling get rich quick. Anyway, the point being, a couple of lads who've got a very big sphere of influence are talking about things. And, you know, I don't think anyone here is going to be surprised, but I doubt any of you are going to listen to anything they say and go, wow, I'd never thought of that. And that's not really the point of this reaction video, which is what it is, essentially. But what is interesting is their cultural position, their clout, I think the youth call it, their clout. If anyone's got another word for clout, am I? Oh, their clutch. There you go. We talked about it. You know, they get those clutch points made. I've looked into the whole arrest in, where is it, Bulgaria, I think. And I have to say, I've only had his side of the story. Oh, no, that's not strictly true, because I've seen people interviewing him who are clearly not on his side. It looks suspicious. It looks like they wanted to shut someone up. It looks like they wanted to. And it's kind of complex how these things work, because everyone's like, yeah, but the Streisand effect, you know, he's got more eyes on him. Yeah, but a lot of other people are like, yeah, I don't know about talking about that sort of stuff. It's all right for the Tate brothers. They got a few quid. They've got, like, probably the best lawyers in the world. Have I got that? Robert Murray, drug specialist on everyone in Dartford speed dial. Hello? I'm inside for hate speech. So we'll have a look at it and we'll deal with it. But has Tate got some clutch angles? I'm using it wrong, and I'm using it wrong. Apparently he wasn't pimping. It's cam girls. He does cam girls, and all the girls that he apparently trafficked have, you know, just said, no, I work for him. It's business. And that's why, you know, they will almost certainly just walk free. It's a crazy story. I don't know the whole story, so I'm not, I'm about to say not comment on it. But 8-9 minutes in, I've been commenting on nothing about that. And at 9 minutes, I think it's time to bring your friend of mine, Francis Foster. Hello. Son.
Hello. You all right?
First thing, I said I wouldn't do this, but sorry about the other night, the last stream.
What?
I don't know what happened. You know what? I thought my channel might have reached its natural conclusion. Seriously. I had a long think afterwards. I thought, maybe you've just run out. You've had your 9 years. And maybe you just haven't got it in you anymore, son. One slightly bad stream. I was very angry at the beginning. And then I ran out of energy. And I thought, yeah, you're too old, you're too tired. I mean, I have got it coming at me from a few directions at the moment. But who hasn't? That's life. And I've always had it coming at me. I think getting my, and I know this just makes everyone laugh, but getting my manuscript in at the deadline, which I did, actually, that really took it out of me. You know, I was staying up till like 8 o'clock in the morning, waking up at midday and getting back on it. It's not only, you know, do that Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then start work Monday morning. No. And then going, oh, no, I'll do a stream. Hello, hello, bugger, hello, hello. So that's a long-winded apology that really gives you no room for reply.
Okay.
There you go. Look, wonderful. Combined with your persona, of course. So here we go, people. What I need to do, look, we've got some right OGs turning up. Henry Hill's on the firm. I am not still in Thailand. I'm in Cambodia. No, she doesn't steal me assets. Her grandmother needs a new buffalo, but apart from that, steal me assets. 6 years we've been together. One of the most loving relationships I've ever had. The same fella. I don't know who you are, Karma Kami. What, did you go by another name? You're more than welcome, of course. I just don't recognise the name. The only good points, I like a bit of points, Tate makes, he stole from others on normal psychology. Well, I'd argue that there's such a thing as normal psychology, but again, and you weren't to know this until I said it, but it's not, we're not looking at the intellect of Andrew Tate and his brother. We're looking at their clout. We're looking at their ability to influence large numbers. Their biggest viewer group is like 15 to 25 year olds. And if there was ever an age group that in Western societies needed a little bit of balance against the Marxist orthodoxy, it's your 15 to 25 year olds. So that's why I thought it would be interesting. We're not going to watch this and go, oh my God, did he just say that? Have you ever thought of it like that before? But it is interesting, and they've also got a very interesting dynamic. They're much like Packer and Dangerfield. Sorry, God, what came over me? Dangerfield and Packer light. They're like a low-res version of me and you, Packer, you know. Yes, they've got a bit more money. I think they probably smoke more money's worth of cigar in this clip than me and you have ever earned combined. But I'm quite getting, I quite like their dynamic. So they do this show on, oh, hang on, I've got to tell you something else. And this is relevant. This has got something to do with it. Because of my work, I'm in e-commerce and I have to dispatch orders and all that. And I've told you before that in the United States, every day, let me just get my calculator out so I can give you the yearly number as well. Hang on. I don't know how to work it out. I don't know how to do that as a decimal. If you just saw what I wrote, you'd be cracking up. Hang on. Is this going to give me a number so big? Oh, no, I can work that out. Every day in America, 1.7 million deliveries are stolen from people's doorsteps. That does include courier thefts, because sometimes the couriers scan them and go, yeah, that's been delivered. There's a signature. Put that in my bag. Feels heavy. 1.7 million packer a day. In a year, that's 620 million parcels going missing. And the point being, the reason that didn't used to happen is because everyone had a bit of skin in the game. In the street I grew up in, if something got delivered, if they weren't in, the bloke delivering it, usually Royal Mail back in the day, they'd knock on your door. And if no one was in there, they'd go up another one and then another one. And it'd usually be my house. Oh, hello, they've got this for number 28. And my mum would be like, oh, that's Nella and Joe. Yeah, they won't be in till like 7:15 on the dot because they've gone to the dog racing. And, you know, they knew exactly. And they'd just give it to you. And when they come home, they'd either have a bit of paper or they'd knock on all the doors and go, do you? But now people don't know their neighbours. And that is immediately a problem because, like I said, everyone's struggling for resources. And the delivery service, excuse me, what's the word I'm looking for? The society that the likes of your UPS, your DHL, your USPS, your Royal Mail, Parcel Force, all that lot, the society that they're working in and that they that their business successfully supplies and fulfills no longer exists. You know, that's a fact. We do not live in high trust societies anymore. We've talked about this a million times. When I was growing up in the summer, well, when it was warm enough, all the front doors were open, even if people went out. And, you know, as a kid, I'd just run in and out of people's houses. You go in, they'd give you a glass of orange juice and a couple of biscuits, and you'd just sit there, and it was all right. And then, you know, someone would come around and ask if they could throw me through the upstairs window because they'd forgotten their key or whatever. But that stopped. On that same street, people do not know their neighbours' names. Now, I know that's not the place all the time, but in inner cities it is. I lived in two properties in Soho, and in one of them there was, and I can tell you because I can picture the letterboxes, the parcel boxes, 12 people living there. I knew one of them, just his name. I knew his name. You know, these are people you sleep 7 foot away. There might be a wall in between you. And so the courier service, and, you know, they won't catch up until they have to, but I will regularly dispatch an order, you know, 700 quid's worth, usually $700 worth, in fairness. And the customer says, "Oh, yeah, I made an order 2 weeks ago. It hasn't arrived." So my customer service checked the tracking. No, it says delivered here, signature. I tell them, they're like, "No, I haven't got anything." Now, I use a third-party fraud service who then put their name and address and all that through a database. I don't want to know where they got that from. And they'll say to me, they've never lost a parcel or done this before, ever. And they'll give them a mark out of 100, how likely it is that they're scamming you and all that. And they're not. Most of the time, they're not. And I have to then send that $800 order again. How much profit do you reckon I've got left? You know? And then they might say, "I don't want it." And by law, if they change their mind within 30 days, they can send it back. And it's free shipping. You have to do free shipping because of Amazon. Amazon has turned us into a nation of entitled customers. So... yeah, and if they want to send it back, you have to free ship it back. You have to refund them their shipping. So it might have cost you $40 to send it to them. You've lost one, and they send it back. That's not, so $80 down on shipping. And you've got to try and run a business like that. Now, this is relevant to what we're going to get onto. I know it feels like a bit of a tangent, and it is, but listen to some of these numbers. Excuse me. I have got a bit of a throat on the go. This is from last year, 2023. 17% of Americans have had a package stolen in the last 3 months of the time of this study, right? Package thieves stole more than $8 billion in merchandise in 2023. Now, put that into perspective. Now, I'm no mathematician, and the equation to actually work out the value here, I mean, unless it's A plus B equals C, I'm gone. But GDP, gross domestic product for America last year, was approximately $24 billion. So a third of the gross domestic product was robbed off of doorsteps. Now, I know that doesn't match up. You know, that's not as simple as, well, you know, but there's an equivalency there that makes you think, shit, you know, this isn't a small thing. And when does it end? Because I'll tell you where it ends. It ends where you don't get stuff delivered anymore. There will be centres where you'll have to go to. And the weird thing is that is in absolute opposition to the way things are going. And it's a real glitch in the matrix, really, because, you know, you don't want to go out your house. People don't want to go out anymore. They want to sit at home, getting fat, watching telly, eating Cheetos. And you're going to say, "Nah, we don't deliver anymore because your countrymen, your countrymen steal too much. It's made it untenable." And also, while we're on that, near 58% of Americans work for small to medium enterprise businesses. So it's small to medium enterprise businesses that are doing things like dispatching. So it's them that are losing. You can't, that can't continue. That small to medium enterprise, SME, we'll call them, because that's what people are doing. I don't want to keep spitting all over my keyboard saying small to medium. It just can't carry on. You know, people stop trading because they can't. Is that if there's no profit in business? So that does all actually link in with this. So if anyone's turned up late, the tilde area regarding this is, I didn't really enjoy what I saw of Andrew Tate and his brother. Duckboy Jordan sent me a link. They're growing on me a little bit in just in terms of their humour, and they have got quite a funny angle, but also the scale of their audience. And when they do on their Rumble channel, which has got over 2 million followers, and don't forget, how many videos do you watch that you're not subscribed to? You know, 60% of the people who watch my lockpicking channel aren't subscribed. So if a video, I mean, I had a short with 3.5 million views, pick the biggest one. I've had about 100 with like 5,000. But loads of people, I've only got like 15,000 subscribers on that channel, but more than that, watch it. So even this Rumble channel probably goes out to 4 or 5 million people, if not more. You know, Duckboy Jordan sent it to me. There's an example. In all of social media, you know, like my Substack, what? You don't know that I'm a writer? That's weird. Packer, where can they find a link? You muted, mate, or you don't know.
In the description.
There you go. It's called Substack. But when I say a like and a comment is really helpful, and it is on my Substack, yeah, I'm a writer, top link in the description. When someone likes it or I get a comment, it gets me more engagement. The Substack SEO give me more authority. It's all good. But a share is golden. A share, someone shares your work, that's absolute gold. The internet knows it. The internet thinks, hang on a minute, Gmail knows that someone shared that video with me and I've watched it 2, 3, now 4 times, you know. So it's not a long section. It's about 30 minutes we'll watch. We'll see how it goes. I mean, maybe people will be really into it. Now, what I need you to do is let me know whether you can hear this when I play it. Because if you can, I don't want to have to be muting myself, and I'll pop my headphones in. Problem is, I've been having a bit of trouble with these, so that could slow things down. So I know you can't see it. Hey, of course you're going to have to. I want to know whether you can hear it through. I've got to put my headphones in, haven't I? Sorry, people. This hopefully won't take too long. Unless there's a problem. Hello, 42. Hello, R-Pill. I didn't know whether to go for Pizzle or Pal, so I went for neither. R-Pill. Hello, Goy Division. Hello, Karma Kami. Check it out. Look, you're still doing the same technical difficulties routine. Look, mate, I said it about 3 weeks ago on this very channel. This channel is about 13 months of material that just loops. All right, that's it. Let me see if I can get this sorted out. Settings. This might actually, I wish this was a routine because choose where to play sound. No, this don't look good at all. This isn't looking good at all. Let's go back. Bluetooth devices. Let's connect them. Well, it says it's connected. Oh, Packer, can you hear me?
Yep.
Has my quality of my microphone changed? No?
Not particularly, no. It's all good.
Hello, MC Dub Power. Hello, Emma. People in the chat. Hello, Anglo. I didn't see you lurking about, my friend. Has my microphone stayed the same?
Yeah.
It pizzle. I like the sound of it. Okay, because I was a bit worried that it might have used these for microphones, and they're terrible at microphones. Right, so let's just jump into this. I'm hoping that the Tate brothers won't yeet me for promoting, shall we say, Susan. I'm not promoting it. These are their views. I'm just reacting to it. All right. This is going to be a tightrope, Packer. And if you wouldn't mind also walking it, if you know what I mean, that would be handy. Imagine that, Packer. Imagine you destroyed my channel.
I've threatened it.
What, in other company?
No. The other day, I said, next time you wander off and leave me on my own talking or something, I was going to just say everything I could think of that would get your channel banned.
The key part of that sentence was when you wandered off, which is why I didn't hear you threaten it. So hopefully this will all work a treat now. And again, you know, there's no mega brains, but think of their clout. Think of how many people they who listen to this. And again, the numbers of 15 to 25 year old European men. Right, let's do a sound check. Let me know you can hear this, people. I'll play a little bit.
Okay, because I get it. They're shooting the messenger.
Right, did you hear that, people? Andrew Tate said, I get it. They're shooting the messenger. Scoring has saved the day for the grift as I can't stay. Amazing. That was the other thing that done me the other night. 48 minutes I'd been talking for, no donations. And I don't give a shit what anyone says. Well, I do, because I care about people's opinions. But when people aren't enjoying a stream, they don't tend to donate. And after 48 minutes, I've got nothing. And I was thinking, you're shit at this now.
It was all right. I think just people are probably just skint.
No, I get that. Obviously, I mean, I am for sure. But what I thought, Packer, look at Packer putting his name, Francis Forster. It's too funny. I wouldn't be surprised if he's trademarked that name. Oh, I need it. I need it when Constantine finally gives me the boot when he doesn't need me to lick his ass clean. Bark at a school every 10 seconds. Thank you, Scorry. But, you know, it wasn't just that. It was a load of different things coming at me from different angles. I'm just trying to work it out, Pack, and see if I can get me and you a little bit bigger. Oh, no, that's not what I
was after. That's fine.
That's not great either. I think I'll go back to the original one. That don't work too well for you, does it? Oh, for fuck's sake. Excuse my language, people. Right, we'll go back to that one. I think I might just go to the full page and then just come back to me and you. How about that, Packer?
Yeah, whatever you like.
Better for the audience. Thank you, Scorry.
There you go, Anglo's in as well.
He has, have it. Go on, look. Even though I told him that I reckon AI can cut a cow in half, he still has faith in me. I put something brutal on Twitter earlier. I said, if you're a writer and you think AI will replace you, it probably will. If you're actually scared that AI can write your novels ain't worth writing. So I'd rather AI do them. Right, anyway, thank you, Anglo. Is that still on the screen? Yes, it deserves it, air and centre. Although I have to take it off because human says, you're not too shit.
There you go.
There you go. That's all it takes, isn't it, humans? You know?
Thanks for the boost.
You don't have to be great, just not too shit.
Well, I mean, that's
I suppose I could get some kind of culture industry analysis out of that if I really tried.
That's true of so many things.
Go on, Packer. Feel free to elaborate. Isn't it?
You don't have to be fucking... You just have to be not too shit.
Like, well, you know. Jick, Jick, I have already said that, mate. I'm assuming you turned up late because that's what Mark Collette said as well. You know, they've made their money. Again, these aren't Mark's exact words, but they've made their money conning young white men. Okay. But I'm just putting that aside because does that necessarily mean what they say doesn't have an effect? So let's just get into it. There you go. The old late cummerbund. Good call. I don't know why I like late cummerbund. Do you like late cummerbund? Do you know what a cummerbund is, Booker?
I've worn one.
Fuck. Hang on, mate. Like, let me think. Best man.
No.
Theatre?
No.
Wedding? Yours?
No.
Right, hang on, don't say. Right, there's 1,000 scrub points. Hello, Colonel Custard. There's 1,000 scrub points up to win. If you can guess why Packer wore a cummerbund. That's incredible. Lulu says, who's the guy on the right? Do you fancy him, Lulu? That is Tristan Tate. That's his brother, who I think is actually the better of the two. Johnny says, Colt, but a cummerbund. That is a cummerbund. You wore a cummerbund to Colt, you got issues. Look at this. Look, 42, who's stolen all my subscribers, and he's having it right off of his stream, doing a cracking job, has got the cheek of donating. It's almost like he's almost slapped me around the face with a wet tenner packer. I don't know if I even want to read it out. No, I thought he was going to say, I'm no fan of you, Dangerfield, then for a minute. Right, hang on.
Maybe he's just seeing it in his juice.
I'm only breaking your balls, 42. I'm getting so many good reviews for your channel. I hear it kicked off when old R. Pizzle was, and you had the Flat Earthers on or something. I'm yet to watch the stream, but Packer.
So wonderful, Chris. I'll give it a look.
Yeah, Packy. I just called you Packy. It's probably not the first time now, is it? Let's be honest.
No.
42 says, I'm no fan of Tate, but they are less damaging to young men than Jordan Peterson, which is their only redeeming quality. Right, you might change your mind a little bit when you see what they say here, 42. But interestingly, another YouTuber said that the Tate brothers are the antidote to Jordan Peterson. So you're on trend, as it were. Thank you for that, 42. Much appreciated. You've been around here years. You're one of the OG GGOs. You're an NGO. That didn't turn out well, did it? I made so much effort to praise him, and I just cunted him off from start to finish. Excuse the language, people. Humans reckons that Packer might have worn it when you were the president of Pakistan. He reckons you wore it at... Hello, Mark. Mark's based off of Mark reckons you wore it out clubbing. Please tell
me. Just going clubbing, yeah. Yeah.
Did you really? Please say
no.
It is. No. Casino from James. Good call, James.
No.
All right, like a stag night.
You know, you won't get it.
You won't get it.
That's why I laugh, because you're not going to get it.
All right, no. We're sticking with it.
Oh,
we're
go
sticking
on, then.
With it. If you see anyone in the chat that's got it or that's near getting warm, let us know.
Yeah, I've got to scroll back because I wasn't really paying attention.
No, I never do.
No.
Just forget what I just said. Don't worry about it.
Right.
Hello, so Nigel. Nice to see you. Ah, oh, look at 40s. For a man who can barely talk, he's got a lot of front, that boy. I'm trying to give back. Amazing.
There you go. Amazing. See?
Right, well, before we get into this, Teddy Dutton's coming on. Give me a one in the chat if you've noticed. I mean, you can't avoid it, to be honest with you. If you watch YouTube, Robert Sapolsky, Harvard University biologist, has just released a book called Determined. And Robert Sapolsky is a free will absolutist. He says you have absolutely no free will whatsoever. I'm sitting here now. I've got
one second. I thought you said free will.
He doesn't believe
it's a free will absolutist. I'm like, oh, okay.
All those Robin Reliance you've seen, AI yeah. generated holograms. Rags is on the firm. Nice to see you, mate. So I picked up this, which is one of those that my dad made. You'll see these all around London on the floor if you look. And I've now picked up my vape. And I've now put my, I'm going to put this down first. And then I'm going to pick up my brass knuckles. And I'm going to put them down. I'm going to have a vape. Robert Sapolsky will have you believe that everything I just done has been predetermined going back thousands of years, going back to the chemical swamp, going back to the mood my mother was in when she was giving birth to me, when she was holding me. What's that called, Packer? Pregnant? When she was pregnant. Okay. Anyway, you know, all we are products of all the things that come before us. And then all we are responses to the things that happen around us. Now, the natural and quite healthy small amount of narcissism we all carry doesn't want to take that, does not want to take that. We don't want to admit that we are not us.
Who's this bloke, Chris? What's his name?
Robert Sapolsky. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, but he done a series of lectures. He's a Harvard lecturer. He's a biologist, human evolutionary biologist. And he done a series of lectures on YouTube. I mentioned it last year and they're...
So is he saying that, like, is he saying
Wait, hang on. I'll just give you the backstory. I mentioned all these lectures that he'd done were fantastic. He'd done human sexuality. He'd done addiction. He'd done this. He'd done that. And they were great. And they were all on their Harvard lectures. You know, he's lecturing at Harvard. So, you know, you don't have to end up at Harvard to get that kind of quality lecturing. But he's released a book. And at the moment, I think I have seen about 15 interviews with him because he's promoting his new book called Determined, because the whole free will thing is about determinism, isn't it? So it's a little play on words. The book's called Determined. He's promoting it, but I've watched a few of his videos. Whenever I turn on YouTube, every video is Sapolsky on another. Hello, Manny Moo. Nice to see you. Well, apparently, I mean, I'm with you, John. I'm strangely weird. I don't know, but here's the good news. Teddy, that is the Eddie Dutton, has agreed to come on this channel and talk about it. Not Robert Sapolsky, but about free will. And let me whisper this in your ear. Teddy Dutton is also a free will absolutist. He doesn't believe in it. He says it doesn't exist. So that will be... Win Stoner says he studied baboons on trikes. He did study baboons. He was out in Africa when the Tooties and the other lot kicked off. He's had some weird old times. Interesting bloke. But anyway, so look out for that stream. Hopefully be 2 or 3 weeks. Teddy Dutton, Professor Teddy Dutton, sorry now. Is going to come on here and we'll discuss free will and the lack of it. You and me are nothing. Well, that's not fair. But we're not what we think we are. Mousecat says, what type of doggy has Tate got in that pic? That looks like a Staffordshire Bull Terrier to me. A long-legged staff. If anyone else would like to have a punt, but that looks like a Staffordshire Bull Terrier. He's had his ears clipped. They like to do that so that they look like a breed that doesn't actually exist, which is the American Pit Bull. But that isn't a breed. It's a behaviour. Nonetheless, nice one, Mousecat. A Prasha Canuti. We've got another one here. Oh, hang on. How comes it says 4 there? 1, 2. Oh, no, done them all. Lovely. Right, let's actually get into this. A few more people. Hello, Toffee. Hello, Kajetal. Anglo reckons it might be an American staff. I reckon he's chopped his ears off to look like that, though. You'd have trouble getting one into Europe. Hello, Lartus, but I don't know. Pizzle says front wheel skid. Kajetal says Dutton's channel's blowing up soon at 100k subs. Yeah, I just lost 100. Not 100,000. 100. I'll get them back in a year, but then another 100 will go. Yeah. This place is for special people. You know, as in school and Olympics.
Thanks for having me.
Well, there you go. IR says they look very gay. I think that's unfair because I think we should avoid saying things like that. Not that I've got a problem with homosexuality. It's always been around. It's always
yeah, some bloke around. Who just sits around on streams with dark glasses on and no top.
Do you know what I mean?
I mean, you know.
But I think it the whole sort of, oh, look at men playing sports ball. They're, you know, getting rubbing over each other, you know, hugging each other. I think we need to be careful about that because blokes can, you know, congratulate each other. Blokes can mean something to each other without necessarily being homosexual. You know, he's just got no top on because he's absolutely... No, I know that, Lulu. Not a problem. I am, about an hour ago, I was going to actually get this stream on. But I think it's important that, you know, it further atomizes us. You know, me and my mates, if I haven't... Like, my mate Trevor Locke come and see me the other day. He was out here doing a gig. I got a message from him about 12:45. Do you want a late cup of tea? I was over the moon to see him. As soon as I see him, it's a cuddle, it's a hug.
Yeah.
Because I'm happy to see him. Couple of taps on the back. Obviously, then it's like, yeah, you know.
Yeah, that's perfectly normal.
Yeah, yeah. I get a little bit funny with people. We have to be careful. We, you know, groups of men don't. I'm not saying you are insinuating this, but groups of men. I can't let that go. I can't let. Toffee says, "Don't take the piss out of homosexuals." JP will be offended. That's cracking. Foxing ban is a really weird turnout. They hello, Foxing ban. They looks like the subject matter has brought in a load of people that I don't know from before. Thank you, Goy. I think I just saw you say correct or something, but it's certainly a trope that I've seen over the last sort of 10 years where, you know, people are separated. Men are separated for daring to show feelings for each other. But look at the Vikings. Do you think the Vikings had the success they had if they didn't have that kind of camaraderie? You know, you don't just show it by going, "Hello, mate." You know, you distinguish people from other groups by being exclusive to yours. You don't hug that person over there because they're not your group. You know, you have to have it, those exclusive things. Anyway, miles off comment. Let's actually get on with this and see what the brothers Tate have got to say. As I said, I doubt you'll learn anything new, but just think of the scale of these two. Their Rumble channel is called TATESPEECH. It's a little play on words. And they call it something like emergency... Hang on, let me just... So I don't get it. Emergency meeting. So in their eyes, they've got to do an emergency meeting. And this emergency meeting, number 46, if you want to go and see it, is called White People. Now, Andrew Tate and Tristan Tate are mixed race. I think they're about a quarter black or something. Andrew Tate has also recently converted to Islam. Tristan is a Christian. It's easy to remember because it rhymes. So let's go. Let's get into this. Let me know if there's any audio problems. If there's not, I'll just keep it playing. Well, I won't because I'm going to respond to it.
You're highlighting a very real problem. And all you need to do, by the way, is look around any major European city that was 99% white 100 years ago. Take a fucking walk. Take a walk. and you'll see exactly what Andrew's talking about. And this is coming from two mixed race dudes. If I went to China and I went to a Chinese city.
Apologies, I've gone too far forward. Sorry, let's try it from here.
Their wives.
Right, yeah.
I had one, that's enough. Sorry, I don't care if it's boring. I had to go through childbirth.
We're going to have to get a bit of this back of what they're talking about to make sure we get the front of the bit I want to talk about. But, you know, that's just my lack of planning and inability to stream on YouTube anymore.
So that's why they're actually butthurt, because their wives said no. So they want to yell at me. So I've got some really important stuff to show here.
Right,
so
here we go.
Because I want to prove my point. I don't want to actually just troll and put up dumb shit. I want to show something important.
Okay, because I get it. They're shooting the messenger.
Notice on the whiteboard in the background, it says urgent boners. Now, just in case you've only just rocked up or you don't know, the fellow on the left is Andrew Tate. The fellow on the right is his brother, Tristan Tate. Okay?
And they are not the boners in question.
No, but they are talking about there's urgent boners. I think they've got quite a nice dynamic, man. Anyway, that's not what's up for debate here. Roll VT. Packer, do you want to call Roll VT?
Roll VT.
Sure. You're highlighting a very real problem. And all you need to do, by the way, is look around any major European city that was 99% white 100 years ago. Take a fucking walk. Take a walk. And you'll see exactly what Andrew's talking about. And this is coming from two mixed race dudes. If I went to China and I went to a Chinese city.
They're fucking.
Because I wanted to see Chinese culture. And everyone was fucking Argentinian. I'd be pissed. And I'm not even Chinese. If I went to Mexico and walked around Mexico City to enjoy some Mexican food and everyone was fucking Afghan, I'd be annoyed. That's not the way Mexico should be. Cultures should be what the cultures are. If I went to anywhere in the world and the culture had been completely replaced, I'd be like, well, this is a bit weird. But when you say it about Europe and you're white, you're a racist. And when you say it about Europe, when you're mixed race like us trying to help the white people out, you're a nigger. Or a Jew. You're a Jew now. So
I'd like to apologize for that racial slur. I think because he's mixed race, he's allowed to say it. I don't know the rules, but there you go. But this is the contradiction at the root of globalism. We're told diversity is a strength, that, you know, different peoples, different ethnicities, different cultures, essentially, different ways of being, different ways of making art, music, painting, literature, food, you know, everything that different people do, that's a strength. You know, diversity being a strength has been shoved down our necks, our throats, and our children's throats for the last 30, 40 years. The problem is, with globalism, it's the brown plasticine, isn't it? When you first get your plasticine, you've got blue, green, yellow, orange, pink, you know, you've got a nice, well, let's do the rainbow. Red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet. Oh, a nice range. And you start making nice little things. And oh, look, it's Papa Smurf. He's blue and he's got a little white hat. But after about 3 months and your brother doing like making penises and things and you trying to make a almost life-size pair of boobs with it, you're having to use all of it. Over a period of time, you've just got a big lump of brown plasticine.
Are you saying, Chris, that all them colours of the rainbow that you started with, or to put it another way, everything woke goes to shit?
Well, essentially, yeah. It's an inherent contradiction at the base of globalism. Because, you know, there is traditional Indian music. There is traditional African music, there's traditional English music, there's traditional Irish music, there's traditional music from many nation states that are defined by a border, defined by an ethnicity, a history, a culture, and traditions. Now, when you mix all of those up, in 100 years' time, in 50 years' time, what's traditional Indian music going to be? What's traditional English music going to be? You know, you're gonna lose this diversity that we're told is a strength. And in 500 years' time, you'll have one type of music. It's the music that the world makes. You'll have one, you know, I don't really go with the Kalergi thing, but he says it. He talks about one culture, one vision, one diet, one true religion. But so there you go. And that's what he's saying. You know, in Europe, it's considered normal to go to the capital city, London. I lived there for a couple of decades. You go to the capital city, and the native ethnicity is in a minority. Now, if you went to Thailand and went to Bangkok on holiday, and Thais were the minority, you'd be like, whoa. Something's gone a bit wrong here. If you went to Beijing and Afghans were the majority population, you'll be like, hang on a minute. If you went to Canberra in Australia and Africans, if you went to Nigeria and they were all Germans, you'll be like, hang on a minute. And yet, Western Europe, it doesn't follow the same rules. There's this kind of liberal, orthodox leftist kind of, no, it doesn't count. And we've heard people, we've heard David Lammy outright say on his radio show that it's revenge. He said it was revenge for colonization. For the colonial times. And that seems like a weird revenge. And if you're going to admit it's a revenge, surely at the same point you're admitting that it's an invasion. I don't know, perhaps. And again, this isn't anything anyone here hasn't thought of before, but people with this amount of clout, it's kind of interesting. Anglo says... Beyonce done a country album, Chris. Cultural appropriation or grifting? I'll have to have a think about that, actually, Anglo, because country music, as you'd expect, is making quite the comeback in America. And what, obviously, I mean, you can't keep stuffing a different culture down people's throat and not expect... You know, the enemy of globalism is nature. Nature is tribal. Nature is about differences. Nature is about diversity being a strength, but by virtue of its separation. And just saying that could get me in trouble. People don't like that angle. I believe that diversity is a strength. How about that? You never thought I'd hear that. But by virtue of it remaining separate. You know, I want people to be able to travel around the world and discover different cultures. You go to Europe now, you can see them all. You only need a flight to England, Germany, Sweden, and France, and that's three quarters of the world kind of covered. Nice one, Anglo. I'll have a think about that and I'll get back to you. Good call. Thanks for the donation as well. Where were we? All right, I'll let it run a bit. I'll try not to keep interrupting. Boy, no way, man. My Dr. C. Lily brother's on the firm. Nice to see you, son. Yeah, love it. Me too, Neil. There you go. But no, not that kind of naturalism. Not running around in the nuddy. That would be ridiculous. Cracker's having problems. Listen to all that fumbling. Mute yourself if you're going to crank one out, Packer.
Sorry.
Right. Thank you, Anglo. Here we go. Let's see these boys carry on. I mean, this is pretty wild on these boys' show, I think.
Well, somehow. I don't get it. I don't understand what they're trying to do. Like, the point is completely valid. Ooh, great. You could say about any country in the world, they shouldn't be replacing the native population with outsiders. And everyone agrees. Here in Romania, they'd agree. hey, guys in Romania, do you think we should replace all the Romanians with a bunch of people from the Democratic Republic of the Congo? The Romanians will say no. Let's have a bunch of Romanian kids. And Romanians are doing a bit better than Western Europe, but all white people in Europe are really not pulling their fucking weight.
So I found this. I can't make it fit on the screen, even though I'm Mr. Producer. I'll read it out to you guys. Basically, if you type in anything about not having kids, there's loads and loads of propaganda trying to convince specifically white people to white not people, have kids. Yeah.
There's no campaigns in Nigeria telling people not to have
Antinatalism
kids.
Antinatalism is the philosophical idea that people should abstain from having children because they think it's morally bad. Antinatalists believe...
I mean, the likes of you and I call it noticing. You know, they've noticed. And it's true. You know, you go online and you find all that propaganda about global warming, overpopulation, and whatever you think about that, John Mannimoon, but whatever you think about that, it doesn't matter. The point is, it's always targeted at white people. You're the one. The ethnicity that is already not breeding at replacement rates. It's very simple maths. If there's two of you, you've got to produce more than two people, because otherwise you're just producing yourselves. And that you know, so it's got replacement rates is like 2.1. Anything more than just yourselves. And you go online and you look for it, and it's hashtag not always, hashtag but nearly always, telling white people not to breed, telling liberal white Guardian readers, oh, you having kids, that's causing terrible tornadoes in Africa, you horrible people. Stop fucking, will you? There's all sorts of things. Other cultures are actively encouraged to breed. And when there's not enough food or infrastructure in their country to support their 17 children, don't worry. Don't worry. There's loads of people paying taxes over there. You can just send them there. They'll pick you up halfway across the water and give you a nice hotel or phone, and you can bring, once you've signed a few forms, you can all come in. Because the native population aren't breeding at replacement rates. And it's almost like it's not connected. If you can't see the connection there, you can't see anything.
Believe it is wrong to bring an unwilling child into the world solely for the pleasure of its parents. Some are put off having children for environmental reasons.
Oh, 42 says, who has 0.1 of a child? Now, I could make a joke about that, 42, but you could probably... Packer's smiling, so that's a good measure that, you know, I think everyone gets what 0.1 of a child is. Continue. Call it, Packer, can you?
Go.
No.
Roll video.
Nearly.
Roll the tape.
VT.
VT, that was it.
Oh, now put it all together.
Roll VT.
Oh, or as a way to prevent the planet's overpopulation. While for many more, antinatalism is a standpoint that is deeply rooted in philosophy. That's right, climate change. They're now saying the sun's too hot, so you don't have kids.
Yeah, your baby will make the weather hot.
It's true. Don't have it.
Your baby will make the temperatures rise, and your baby will kill the polar bears.
Nice. Let's find other people who said that white people should have kids and didn't get spurged on. Because it wasn't only me.
Okay.
Oh, this video is not working. Fine.
I thought you were Mr. Producer.
I am Mr. Producer. So instead, I'm just going to show a video. I'm going to show a picture of every... Did you know every hotel in the world has a chair for white people?
Hello, Charlie.
It's a cuck chair.
I'm not sure that's true. I think people in hotels just might want to sit down sometimes.
I spoke over quite a funny joke there. Notice the chair next to the bed. Let me just take it back a little bit. Hopefully this won't take it back too far. Hang on.
Okay, fine.
I thought you were Mr. Producer.
I am Mr. Producer. So instead, I'm just going to show a video. I'm going to show a picture of every... Did you know every hotel in the world has a chair for white people? It's a cuck chair.
I'm not sure that's true.
I mean, it's a joke, but that's how we're seen. You know, it's a cuck chair. It's where you sit watching your missus at it with someone else. You know, these are the people that... This is the British Empire. That's, you know, that's the history of those people. Warriors, inventors, scientists, fighters, thinkers, philosophers, intellectuals who built ships and had the fucking massive cojones to just sail. Let's just go. Let's just go and see if we can find somewhere and plot up there and see if we can make something of it. And now, when you get a photo of a hotel room with a chair next to the bed, and, you know, I'm not taking offense to a joke here, but look at that. That's happened in about, what, 50 years, 60 years, pretty much since the end of the Second World War, where we just, well, we gave, I'm not going to get into that now, we'd be here all night. But, you know, he's got a point there. It's a cuck chair.
I think people in hotels just might want to sit down sometimes.
Nah, I think they're watching the Bretta with her wife.
I don't think that's true.
Destiny would. Ben would.
Destiny would's amazing.
Ben.
Yeah, he's got porn addict all over Ben.
Oh, grow up.
When he talks about Ben, he's talking about Shapiro. Ben would and Destiny would. Hello, Telford.
Up. You're short and wrong. Choose a struggle.
Yeah. Yeah, being short and wrong.
Right. So every nationalist leader in history, the first thing they did was encourage population boom. So as a person here, if I'm trying to encourage a population boom, I'm clearly on your team. To come along and say you need to have children is what someone who believes in the nation, a nationalist, would say. None of my videos are working.
Announcing a series of tax and loan benefits for...
Sound only and the screen stays black.
He's nearly as good
Shut
as
up.
Me, eh?
Let me fix that. Urgent boners.
But yeah, that's what good leaders do. That's what leaders who care about their countries do. That is absolutely true. Yes, they try to encourage the country to produce more people. Because when you think of something like, let's say you buy a microwave oven, okay? And it says made in Germany. You're like, good, made in Germany. The Germans are hardworking, diligent, industrious people. Why don't we...
Oops, apologies. I think someone new turned in. Hello, Apadia Nova. If you're new here, I imagine you are. Say hello, people, to Apadia.
That's my daughter, Chris.
Oh,
no,
that's
one I never told you about.
How much you want for your daughter? Sorry, people. Ignore Packer's daughter. Damn. you can't. Continue. But they're right. You know, we all know what Viktor Orban's up to. You have four kids in Hungary, you never pay income tax. You have four kids, you never pay income tax. Incentivize breeding. You know, why do you need to bring in, you know, we hear it all the time. No, we've got to bring them in. We've got to bring them in. We need the labor. Even though something like more than 60% of immigrant Muslims don't work. No, we need the labor. But Orban doesn't say we've got to bring them in from here and there and everywhere. He says, breed, you won't have to pay income tax. I think if you have one kid, you get a free motor. Seriously, you get a free car or something. I think if you have two kids, you get an interest-free mortgage. Now, if people in the chat can correct me on these, but it's something like that in Hungary. And they go on to talk about Orban in a minute. And that's what a leader who cares about their... nation. And that's all I'm talking about. As I've said many times on this channel, I don't hate anyone. I haven't got the energy to hate people. I want to be constructive. I want to build things. I want to make things better. But I also want to make nation. I also believe in the nation state as a model. And what I've seen of globalism is a destruction of the nation state and all those who live there. I've seen their lives go downhill, and I'm seeing it go downhill at an exponential rate. You know, I left England 6 years ago. My mother died. I went back. My own town doesn't exist anymore. It's heartbreaking. I wanted to show my missus one day. I always thought 10, 15 years, you know, I'm not going to rush on holiday to England. That's nothing against England. I love the place. But the fact of the matter is, can you imagine getting she's never been on an aeroplane, forking out all that money, jumping on a plane and taking her to fucking Dartford? Now, if it was like it was just 10 years ago, I would have done it. you know, that old estate where my mum lives. It's lovely. It's kind of quaint. You know, they're little terrace houses. It's not like, oh, look at the Manor Dangerfield. But it's where I grew up. But it doesn't, it's not Dartford. It doesn't look like it. It's not the same place. Why? Because the people who live there aren't of Dartford. And so that's, how sad is that? You know, she was proud when I first went out to the province, to her province. She was proud of it. And they had fuck all, literally, like little tin houses and like a well to get the water out of it. And like chickens for eggs for breakfast and a knackered old cow. Not knackered, but Anglo might be able to confirm this or not. But they're not full of steroids or whatever. They look hungry.
On a sick buffalo, is it?
Yeah, but they're grazing on green rice. They're grazing on green grass all day long. They just eat what they need to. They're not like full of water or whatever it is. And she was proud. This is where I come from. This is my home. And I can't do that. I'll take her to Dartford and go, well, these streets sort of look like it. But I'm not going to bother. I'm not going to bother taking her there. JP, hello, mate. He says, grew Miata from your base in China. I'm not quite sure what that means, but Packer, can you translate that, or is it a bit?
Yeah, I think you meant your lair in China.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, no, it was base. It was base, wasn't it?
Was it?
This bare-chested, this far-right nationalist operating from his base in Cambodia. Good Lord. What a weird...
It's in a cave with armed guards, like off of a 007 film, isn't it?
They just didn't... You know, they had nothing to go on. They didn't want to mention my Cambodian fiancé because that, you know, kind of ruins their Oh, God. And you know the weird thing? That Sunday Times article that said I was grooming teenage Nazis or whatever it was, the star, you know, that's the lowest of the low. That's the gutter of the gutter, isn't it? When they reproduced that article, it word for word, apart from the bit about me, even the star thought, yeah, come on, that's pushing it. Have you seen his channel? That, you know, when the Sunday Times was like, oh, look at him, look. You know, the star were like, yeah, I don't know about that. Yeah. Anyway, continue.
Why don't you Germans double the number of German people? Because in 50 years' time, made in Germany is going to mean made by sub-Saharan Africans, and you've ruined your own country.
There has been a deliberate psyop on you to not have children for a long time, and it is climate change, feminism, LGBT, Planned Parenthood. All of this garbage is tied up. They are trying to reduce the population. This is obviously accepted by most people, that they want population decline. And they want population decline of hegemonist societies. They don't want white people reproducing. They don't want that. Here, look, this is from the 1930s.
This is Margaret Slee, president of America's Planned Parenthood Federation, maintains that European women should stop having babies for the next 10 years.
Don't you think such a theory, such a radical theory, is antisocial?
On the contrary, it seems to me that it is more practical and humane.
What about the women who want babies now and in 10 years will not be able to have babies? Rather impractical, don't you think?
Oh, John, you do ask hard questions. I should think that instead of being impractical, it is really very practical.
I've got to be a little bit careful because this is British Pathé, which will get me a copyright strike, but I really want you to hear it, so I have to interrupt probably a little bit. William, they do approach it, shall we say, but, you know, I think they're kind of aware. followed by Baz. And then JP, great naval serviceman, comes in to finish the triptych of basically misogyny. Good call, people. I'm going to play a little bit more. Let's see if we can get away with it. If the channel gets yeeted, you'll get a thing on the screen saying this channel has broken the rules. But In 3 minutes, it comes back here. So you don't need to go and find another stream. I don't mean that you desperately want to stay here, but I won't have to start another stream. Sorry, Paco, I've lost the plot. I don't know how to do it anymore.
Just wait. We'll be back in 3 minutes. Just
yeah, that's how.
Go to the loo, make a cup of tea.
There you go. Monster Traps, you must be new. Nice to see you. Nice to have some noobs in. Hello, Pags. How are you? When Tate says they who, could he possibly me? Who? Yeah, there you go. I should have read that before I put it up. Anyway, let's play a little bit more of this, and I'll see if we can. British Pathé, I know for a fact they're copyright matched. Because anyway, I'll give it a go. If I do disappear, go and make a cup of tea and come back.
And intelligent and humane.
But Mrs. Slee, in this country, having babies is the only thing left which is both unrationed and untaxed. Do you think we really ought to stop?
Well, I suppose a subject like that is really so personal that it's entirely up to the parents to decide. But for my view, I believe that there should be no more babies.
Now,
there should be no more babies. It's kind of a clear message there. It's not like a metaphor, is it? No worries, Monster. Sorry about that, mate. I do have to keep a, you can understand that I do forget things. I'm getting old, and I. Anyway, let's carry on with these lads, see what they've got to say.
I want you guys to understand something, that every single agenda that the government tries to purport and push on you has a Trojan horse installed of it. I think we've explained this before.
Many times.
But I'll explain it again. They come along with something that sounds virtuous, right? They say, climate change. And if you're against climate change, well, then you don't love the environment. Yeah, you're a bad person because you don't like trees. Who hates trees, bro? Everyone loves trees.
Everyone.
So they say, well, you gotta love trees.
Amazing that I think about five people there noticed. Hello, Charlie, by the way. Five people noticed that the kicker, don't have any more children. That was when she looked straight at the camera. And it's really powerful when you know, movies do it all the time. You know, once you get eye contact, and especially documentaries use it, and marketing, it's the, you know, there's an AI app I've got. I've only got it as part of another app. Why am I trying to excuse myself? That's what I did for a living. If I make a video or I use someone else to make a marketing video and their eyes look away or aren't looking at the camera, the AI will fix that. It will make sure their eyes are looking at the camera. So I could be talking to you here. I could look over here. I could go like that. I could go like that. I could keep my head still and just look down. And the AI will adjust that so that I'm keeping my eyes on you all the time. And as I've said a million times, if you don't think AI is going to take over, well, it already has. You, just as much as any man who has had more than a few nights out with a Thai lady will have likely had sex with a bloke somewhere along the line, unknowingly, likely you've watched a huge... Really? Paco, I had a relationship...
I'm not laughing at you. I'm laughing
no,
with
I'll
you.
Tell you. No, I had a relationship. It's a long romance. She's a bird in my novel. Link in the description. I'm also a writer. Substack, top one. It's free. she runs free massage parlors, and I have seen many times katoys, which is what they call ladyboys. The punter doesn't know that it's a katoy, and they'll go in the room, they'll give them a massage, they'll turn them over, they'll ask if you want that massage. The bloke's like, oh, why not? They'll massage that, and they'll say, do you want a bit more? You know, it's all, everyone knows what's going on. And then they'll pop that in the back door without you knowing. And I've seen it countless times. Now, I've kind of gone up a tangent there, but my point being, in a similar way to loads of blokes have done that without knowing, you will have consumed content generated by AI and not known. That's already happened to everyone in this chat. I just know because I know the scale of the AI influence in in e-commerce and the internet. You know, it's all over it. Oh, I should do a new video. Some of the new AI software is just mind-blowing what it can do. Anyway, let's get back to the lads.
Of trees, but inside of the agenda, the happy agenda
of save the trees, which we all like trees.
This is a smiley face.
Yeah,
there's a turd
of end your genetic bloodline forever.
So they'll add in somewhere along the bottom, if you have more than two kids, you're a bad person, you want the trees to die, because liberalism is a death cult and they want everything to just collapse. They don't want anything to last very long, especially not the things that built society. So you have to understand all these things they're pushing. LGBT stops you from having families.
But wait a minute. LGBT and all the transgender kids being sterilized, etc. That's a phenomenon specifically in the Black, Pakistani, and Muslim community, is it? No, which community is it? Which community? Which group of people? Is it the Orthodox Jews? Is it the Nigerians? Is it the Pakistanis? Is it the Arabs?
Who's sterilizing themselves?
Which group of people sterilizes their kids in the name of transgenderism? Who is doing that? What color are those people? Chinese?
Interesting. We'll have to work that out.
We have to work it out. So give me some clues in the chat, because I'm trying to figure it out. Which ethnicity is pushing this agenda? Sterilize your kids. It's fine. Don't make your kids reproduce.
Oh, guys, I know you're all mad because Tristan and I have endless suitors and we can have 20 kids with 7 or 8 women who adore us. And you haven't got the same sexual options we have and you haven't got the money to take care of them. I get it. But you can still do what you said you're going to do. Find a wife and have some kids. Do that then.
Yeah, I'll just find a wife and have 8 kids.
Do it then.
Do it. I would.
I'll tell you what, it's very interesting. I'll leave a link to this. Actually, I'll pop it in the chat now. If you go through the comments, very interesting to see what the comments are saying. But there's loads of people who aren't, shall we say, white, who are saying, I'm on my 7th kid. I've just got married. I'm going to have 8 kids. And there's another one like, you know, I'll be pumping them out as long as I can, because that's their culture. That's what's been promoted. In Cambodia, that still to this day, the average, I think, I might get this wrong by a little bit, but the average birth rate of a Cambodian province girl is something like 4.3 children. That's still today. Now, that's gone down. My girlfriend's mother was one of 12. And, you know, that's 2 generations. Well, yeah, 2 generations. It's gone from 12 to 4 and a bit. And this generation, of course, they'll be encouraged, blah, 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 blah. And, you know, we think it's crazy when you hear, you know, in England, when someone has 10 children, that's on the cover of newspapers. This woman's had 10 kids. So maybe she wanted them. Maybe she wanted a big family. Big families are beneficial for many reasons. You know, Cambodian women of my girlfriend's mother's age, I've spoken to him about this. Like, there's one particular woman, she's not quite as old as my girlfriend's mum. I'm older than my girlfriend's mum. I'm not. But she's had like about 8 kids. And I said to her, why have you had 8 kids? And she said, well, they'll look after me. They'll look after their parents. And when the father got killed, as my girlfriend's father got killed, well, there's 5 girls. Well, they had to sell one because when the father got killed, yeah, it's a nightmare story. But there's still 4 kids, which have kept the 104, I can never remember if she's 104, 107-year-old grandma and the mother in house and food, and they all chip in. I've told you this before, but when I talk to Cambodian people about care homes, right, when my mother was still alive, my girlfriend's mother said to me, what are you going to do? You know, where does your mother live was the first question. I said, oh, she lives in England. She said, oh, what, with your family? I said, well, no, I am our family. I've got a brother, but he lives in Japan. And she's like, well, who looks after your mum? And I had, like, guilt, as I should have done. Even though that's culturally curated, you know, I'm sure there's plenty of people here who've got mothers who live on their own. I'm sure there's people here who haven't. But old family members who live on their own. That's unheard of out here. And even if there were someone who, by no fault of their own, lost children or partners or whatever, they'd be taken in by someone in the community because they've still got them here. You know, where my girlfriend lives, near, right near the centre of Phnom Penh, you stick your, like, it's just been Khmer New Year out here and they have the Water and Powder Festival. And it goes on for like 9 days. And you, to see a community come together, it had me in tears because it reminded me of 1977 Silver Jubilee, when my road was closed and everyone painted their lampposts and gardens silver and, you know, all that lark. And we had we had games in the street. Do you remember all that, Packer?
Yeah, yeah, I was a pirate that day.
My old man was doing, my old man was bricklaying at a factory that produced flags. And they give him a flag that was 60 foot, a union flag, right? You know, the St. George's Cross, the Scottish one. And we used it as a tablecloth. And everyone put their tables out in the street. No one was sort of like, oh, I don't know about putting my table out there. It was just, let's, you know, put that union flag over all those tables. All the kids sat there. Everyone chipped in. Everyone was eating. You know, and in the evening, they had a disco arrive. What were they called? We used them all the time for street parties and that. It's not relevant what they were called, is it? But it was something like Sunscape or something. You know, and watching the New Year's Eve celebrations, everyone out in the street playing games. Do you remember polo and versions of that where you drew lines on the street and you used the pavestones and one bloke stood up this end and the other's up that end and they'd say something like five, it'd be like types of cars and then there'd be a spokesperson and they'd sort of go Porsche, Lamborghini, Bugatti, Volkswagen, I don't know any more cars. And then the person, and you know, and they'd shout it and then you had to beat them running backwards and forwards. Well, they were playing variations of that. Adults, toddlers, everyone. But these weren't just families. These were people who lived over there, lived over there, lived over there, lived up there. Everyone knew each other's name. They were playing these games I've never seen before, where like one's in the middle with like a lot of leaves, like a lot of twigs tied together. And they walk around the outside of a circle of about 50 people. And they're all sort of singing and going, it's a, I suppose it's a bit like, Packer, what was that one farmer's wife? That's all I can think of.
For well, no idea.
There used to be a game, something like...
Oh,
the farmer.
Yes, I do remember. Yeah, 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 yeah. He needed a wife, and then wife. They needed a kid and a dog and a sheep and a goat.
I am the owner, farmer. And then they'd pick a girl, and then she'd come out. And yeah, all like that. So it was sort of like that, but then he'd tap someone on the back with this bunch of twigs. And then they'd get up and chase him around. And if he could get back, and this was, you know, it did bring a tear to my eye because I thought, hang on, I was 6 years old, 5 years old in 77. And that's not so long ago. What is it? 42, 43 years, something like that. And it's gone. You ain't going to see that in England. You might see it in the odd village, but even those old quaint villages have been bought up for holiday homes. But in Patong, I nearly said Patong, in Phnom Penh, if I wanted to drive my scooter from my girlfriend's house to the mini mart and then home, I had to be prepared to get buckets of water thrown over me, talcum powdered, and the lot, because every single person was celebrating. They've got communities, they've got families. Now, look, I'm not trying to sell Cambodia to. The same goes on in Thailand. The same goes on in Vietnam. The same goes on all around the world. It doesn't go on in Western Europe. It's over. There's no communities. It's not a homogenous society. I'm sure they do their rituals and those bonding celebrations. You know, play is essential. Play is an essential way for people to, you know, culture is exclusive. When you hear on the telly or whatever, when they say, oh, you can't do that because it's excluding other cultures, that's what culture's for. It's one of the main functions of culture. It's a way of saying, I'm part of this group. You're not. It's not a way of saying we're better than you. It's not a way of saying you're worse than us. It's just admitting that nature is tribal, that people are different. You know, you can't have it both ways, lefties. Don't tell me that diversity exists and in the next breath say it doesn't, which is what you've been doing for like 40 years. You know, it's almost the fundamental function of a culture to be exclusive. And it's no surprise that that's where they attack you first. You know, let's stop people doing rituals, traditions. You know, we all, excuse me. Oh, it's not Happy Christmas, it's Happy Holidays. Yeah, but it is Happy Eid. It is Happy Hanukkah. It's not Happy Easter. It's, you know, Happy Holidays. But it is Happy This and Happy That. They've taken our culture intentionally because it weakens you. That's why you have it. I mean, when you watch the rugby and the New Zealanders do their haka, you think they're doing that for the fun of it because they like a little dance? No, it's power. This is us. Look at us together. Look at us. We go back centuries. We've got traditions. We've got things that bond us. We've got the tattoos. We've got the songs. We've got the songs our forefathers sung, our grandfathers sung, the people before them. This goes back. This is who we are. And it's intimidating. You know, can you imagine the English turned up and said, yeah, we want to do that. We want to do a little march around and do something that's exceptionally English. They'd be like, I don't think so. They'd be like, why not? They'd be like, well, because it's English. You go, well, that's the idea. They'd be like, yeah, I don't think so. But, you know, that's why they attack culture. Kajetel, Kajetel asked me if I've looked at large language models and AI for editing. I've got my editor on it. The thing is, Kajetel, you can't really edit a novel like mine unless you know the novel. It's just, you could probably proofread it, but even then I deliberately break grammar and spelling and syntax rules. And you couldn't teach the AI that because in the next paragraph I'll put them back as they should be. So, you know, I can't line edit, I can't copy edit, I could probably continuity edit, but again, I subvert all those things as a postmodernist. And postmodern isn't a style or a technique, it's not a particular thing, it's in itself, it is subversive. So, no, I have looked into it, yes, because my editor nearly died twice in the last year. But he's such the man for the job, you know, and he's on it. So, you know, he's reading the last draft I gave him now. But nice one for suggesting it. Thank you for the donation. Machano Kaprishkanata Tutu. Kim drops in a bit as well. Seen any Farang ding-dongs? Well, it's Falang. It's Falang, and that means European. So if you're asking me if I've seen any European willies, I mean, I've seen my own. I've seen a few of my mates. But if you're asking me if I've seen any Katoi ding-dongs, yeah. They're shriveled up. It's like a walnut with a maggot crawling out the top because of all the estrogen they pump into themselves. And that's how comes they can get you in the outdoor without you realising it. because they don't take their niggers off. For you think that's just the old Garden of Eden. No, it ain't called that, is it? Pubic noun. Mondas pubis. Pubic mondas? I don't know. Lady garden. But you're actually going in the outdoor. I've been in massage parlours because when I've been out there withdrawing, I just sit in the front room. And when I see that bloke go out the back, I say to the bird, does he know? She goes, no. He's been seeing her all week. He's asked her to go back to France with him. imagine she took him up on it. Gets back to France. Oh, there's one thing I didn't tell you. I'm a geezer. But farang, it's phalang. And it means that's what they call European people. In Cambodia, it's barang. Anyway, nice one, Kim. Where are we? Have I missed any others? 42 said, get to Belfast in July to see a functioning British culture. There you go. Good call. I can't remember, 42, if it was you or Rags, but we had the old marches. Someone showed us the marches and told us, I think Rags it was, who told us the old, no, it was you, or maybe both of you. Nah, it's all Irish to me. But, sorry, that's Arklow, isn't it? Back when we had them both on. Oh, but yeah, we talked about the kids getting involved in the marching bands, as you know, and yeah, exactly that. And as you've told us, 42, you have got cultures out there, you have got communities out there, you have got people helping each other out. But as thank you, 42, for that donation. Thank you as well, Kim, and thank you, Kajetel and JP. But going back to that, what I started off saying about 20 minutes ago, when you talk to Cambodians and Thais about care homes, they can't believe it. To them, that's like an apocalypse. And they will question you, not after more info. They just want to make sure they got it right. They're like, hang on, your mum needs help washing and feeding herself because she's so old. And you'll sort of go, yeah, well, mine doesn't, but some, you know. And they say, so what do you do with them? You say, well, they go to like a place and you pay them and other people do it. Like Packer works in one. He knows exactly what I'm talking about.
I do.
And they're like, yeah, but who's looking after them? And you say, well, they spend quite a fair amount of time just sort of sitting around watching telly and that, or throwing a beach ball at each other. My girlfriend's 104-year-old grandmother, she's up at 5 o'clock in the morning doing the gardening. She's active. And because she's got a family, a reason to live, she's not sitting there with her false teeth falling out going, coffee. You know, they can't believe it. Now, try and imagine that. You know, if I say to you, oh, I've got to send my grandmother to a care home, you'll be like, ah, oh, you know, sad, isn't it? But when you tell them, they can't conceive of ever doing that. They will find the money and they will look after them. You know, and when you see it through their eyes, it's a little bit brutal, isn't it? I mean, I think we have to admit that. And I'm not passing the buck here. This is going to sound weird, but I've been lucky enough that both my parents died within a week of getting ill. So I haven't had to make such decisions. But once you look at it through eyes of a culture who haven't been indoctrinated to making you think that's all right, you know, they raised you. You were in their belly. They gave birth to you. They've done their best bringing you up. And if you're a working class person, like most people here are, that's with very little money. And your old man grafted every day. My old man worked his ass off. He was working 10, 11 hours a day, sometimes 7 days a week. You know, he'd get in, sit down, fall asleep, wake up, have something to eat, go to bed. You know, one shower a week in our house. Well, no, not shower, sorry. That was well too flash. Bath. And we shared bath water. My dad had it last because they'd come out. It'd be like a fucking syrup. But, you know, that's what they've done for you. And what do you do now? What do we do as a culture? Just chuck them in home. And I've said this, and I've heard plenty of people say this. They're like, you know, it looks like we're going to have to put mum in a care home. And then they said, you know, the thing is, they're fucking expensive. And that $450,000 house she's got that she paid £30 a month for, mortgage, that'll probably all get eaten up in the care home. And there's so much to unpack with that comment. You know, she earned that money to pay for that house. And people do consider, to be honest with you, I'd rather have that money. You know, if she, you know, she's given up on life, she doesn't do anything, she just sits there. It seems like a bit of a waste of money, just getting people to keep her alive. But that's the thinking, that's the damage they've done to the West. Care homes. Have you seen in Canada now? You can just go and kill yourself. Now, I think people should be able to kill themselves. I think you've got a right to end your own life. But they're actively encouraging it in Canada now. And it's all part of the mental health myth as well. They diagnose you. Oh, no, you've got depression. It's nothing to do with choices you've made. No, you've got a disease, son. No, you've got it. It's never going to get better. What, the SSRIs didn't work? Yeah, well, double your dose didn't work. Well, triple them didn't work. Yeah, well, chuck some antipsychotics in as well. Didn't work. 3 years of that, you are now fried zombie, but you've still got depression. Well, be honest with your love. It's going to be like this for the rest of your life. Oh, yeah, and don't think about coming off of that medication, because that's going to take you 3 years tapering, and you're going to have head shocks for the whole period. Be honest with you. You might as well just end it. And that is happening in Canada at the moment. Look into it. I haven't made that up. And that, you know, if you haven't seen my video on the mental health, mental illness doesn't exist. If you don't know that, go and find my video. I've made 3 videos on this channel with Professor Jeff Sharla. And that con of mental illness, it all links in with this kind of thinking. That whole sort of... Anyway, let's get back to these boys.
Start now. In 9 months' time, I want, this is an open challenge, in 5 years, if you've had 4 kids in 5 years because of this podcast, and you've named them all something related to the Emergency Meeting podcast, so I know that you made them because I said so,
nice,
and you're a white person, I will give you $150,000. Download this, save it.
Stand on us.
Pump out kids.
Here's a documentary I found about not having kids or having smaller families. And let's notice the ethnicity of everybody. Because what I've seen is I've seen a bunch of white people and one token. They threw in a token because they don't make it too obvious.
Is it me?
No. It's a token from South Park.
Hi.
How much of the world's resources do you think are needed to keep the human world going right now?
40%? 60%?
I can't give you a specific figure because I don't.
Apologies, people. My girlfriend rang. I don't know if you could hear it ringing and all that. Could you hear that ringing, Packer?
No.
So it hasn't ruined anything. All right. I'll just take back a little bit so I'm in tune with what's going on. Hello, Steve. Good to see you, Purnell. Hello, James. James says that homeless in Michigan in winter is a death sentence. Yeah, okay. And I can imagine that. And you've only got to go back 50 years. I'm assuming that wouldn't have happened. Because people know that. Look at all those places around the world where it's just like unbelievably hot or unbelievably cold. And if you're 70, 80 years old, you need help. You know, when people talk about America and the nuclear family and the white picket fence, it had already gone by then. It's already over at that point. Extended families and communities are what are needed. Yes, you need to breed I've forgotten the word now, but you know what I'm talking about. But if you haven't got people willing to look after you to the extent where your culture, your society has built homes where you can get other people to look after them, and let's not pretend everyone watching this video hasn't seen videos on YouTube of immigrants staff beating the shit out of 80-year-old people. It's unbearable viewing. I'm not saying it's only immigrant staff, obviously, but they tend to be the ones that get on YouTube, and I've got no numbers on that. But, you know, we've just taken it for granted. But if you step back from it, it's, yeah, thank you, James. That's much appreciated. Yes, you have to breed at replacement rates. But, hello, John Argentina. Hello, Riddle. Anyway, here we go. We actually, 42 makes a point. Homeless in cold parts of the USA do not even get the get up and go to get. Don't even have the get up and go to get to the warm all year parts. It's a Darwin Award. Oh, they're all looked after though. The people go down there, feed them. You know, they're looked after. You know, if you want to be a meth addict who stabs people in the street and makes life for the working people of your town an absolute misery, oh, no, you're fine. They're the ones the liberals look after. You know, look at those massive camps. They're in loads of Democrat cities. Sam, I've got a friend in San Francisco. He says it's over. He said that San Francisco that you know from 70s movies, he says it's a shithole. He said to me, he said, you know what I can liken San Francisco to? He said, Monday, Glastonbury. And if anyone's been to Glastonbury Festival, Monday morning, he said, that's what pretty much all of San Francisco's like now. And it ain't pleasant, I can assure you. Right, back to the lads.
Token from South Park.
Hi.
How much of the world's resources do you think are needed to keep the human world going right now?
40%? 60%?
I can't give you a specific figure because I don't have any idea.
Heck, that's bad, isn't it? We're using more than the Earth, so...
We only made up 1% of all mammals. What do you think the balance is today?
50-50? No! Oh my God.
Unfortunately, just for the yeeting, because this is obviously a clip they've got, I have to interfere. Hello, Rollo! Rollo, I know I've still got to reply to your email, mate, but I've had a lot on, but I will. Rollo says, my mum lives next door now. Good call, Rollo. That is a good call. She's 91, 8 years old. Your message just moved. She was actuated to the US by her granddad. Her convoy was attacked by a U-boat and the cruiser next to her ship was sunk. I'm blessed. That's amazing. That's what an amazing story. An amazing story of survival. Jared says, that's total bullshit. We have lots of resources. Yeah, I'm on your side with that. I'm not buying any of that stuff at all. I despise this idea that we're raping the planet. We're raping the planet. No, we're using its resources. What else do you do? What else do you do? Now, are there problems with agriculture? Could it be done better? Are there problems with farming? Could it be done better? Yeah. But these things take time. You know, we didn't get onto agriculture for about 5 million years, you know, cut us a bit of slack. Yeah, it's not perfect. But this idea, oh, no, we need to live a holistic life where we just sit there drinking rainwater and eating our own toes. It's ridiculous. And I've got a funny feeling, Jared, that they will get onto that in a moment. James has just learned about nitazines and he's never doing illegal drugs again. The one you want to look out for, James, is levasimol. I can never work out whether it's levasimol or levasimol or lezafimol. But it's cut out sauce with cocaine. 93% of American cocaine added in. Never used to be cut out sauce, but they've got onto it. It's an animal wormer. One of the worst things you can put up your nose. And If you're doing cocaine on the regular, you are doing so much damage to your body. Cocaine hydrochloride isn't actually that much of a damaging drug when used in moderation. Pump it full of animal wormer, and you're looking at something very, very brutal. And again, that's prohibition that's caused that. Yeah, make it illegal and it will kill more people. Lovely. Good point. I don't know you, John. Maybe you're new around here. Either way, you're welcome. Nice to see you. If humans are good at anything, it's adapting to circumstances and new environments. Yeah, that is Darwinism, isn't it? Those that can adapt the best to changing situations and environments. Good call. Don't forget the grift is on, people. Entropy at the top, super chat at the bottom. You can have a go to buy me a beer. That's that QR code. I'll just check that. That's really from a Substack, to be honest with you. So I better check it just in case. Oh, I've got to be 18 to view that. No way! It's 22 hours in here. Is 22 hours still watching this stream? Or maybe they read some of my Substack. 22 hours. Let me know if you're watching this stream. How long ago was that? It doesn't say. Hello, Crow. No way. Did you do that today? That's amazing. 22 hours, bought 10 futures. I don't want to dox you, but that's a significant amount of filthy lucre he's dropped into my... Oh, that's so encouraging. Nice one, man. That's amazing. Thank you very much. Oh, I bet you were over the moon when I said, I'll just give it a little check. I better keep that page open. I've only had it. They said I couldn't have a, they couldn't have it. They said I couldn't have a buy me a beer and I appealed and they went, oh, all right then. Amazing. Thank you, 22 hours. Beautiful. Let's get back on to these boys. I had to interrupt that bit or I'd have got ye.
Boys.
Oh,
what?
I know, I wasn't expecting to be that bad, but yeah.
What you see here are different fertility rates across the world.
There's an obvious north-south divide. I worked in the area of international aid for a number of years. Educating girls just overall has a big impact on the size of family they choose to have.
How do you feel about climate change? Does it scare you or worry you?
Climate change is definitely worrying. Yeah, destruction happening to the world and for our environment, and it's definitely something that we need to pay attention to. Educating or raising...
Whoa. Chris Set says, can you stop pausing this video for 10 minutes at a time, ever 30 seconds, to wander off on random tangents about nothing? No. No, I can't. Absolutely not. And everyone else here knows that. If you look, mate, I'll give you the link to the video and you can just go and watch that if you don't want my input. I mean, what's the point? It's a reaction video. There you are. Go on, shut the door on the way out. There you go, 42. Exactly. I mean, what weird. Can you stop having a channel, please? I'm trying to watch something else. Yeah, sure.
It's just the format and the content, Chris.
I know that, and I'll accept that all day long. And it's also getting yeeted, isn't it? Right. Hello, Otto. I didn't see you here. John's here for the random tangents. Exactly. Without that, I don't know. Yeah, look, I'm getting abuse for crying. Good Lord. Yeah, Chris. Cricks, let's make up and be best friends. Yeah, I'll put high five in the chat to you. I'm only breaking your balls. There you go. But I do have to, thank you, Wreck-It. I do have to interrupt these because this, I will get yeeted. So anyway, I'd interrupt them even if I didn't. Everyone knows that. Here we go.
Raising awareness of what the impact a large family has is a much better way to do it, because then people will make that choice in a positive manner.
Yeah, white people in token. Climate change is so worrying. I'm so scared about climate change.
I know, well, because the people in India, the country that pollutes the most in the entire world, are having,
they don't care,
46 kids each, but I think I should abstain from having,
guys,
like two babies.
Guys, there's, yeah, literally.
You're the Chinese don't care.
There's an Indian with a moped, two-stroke moped that puts fumes into the air, who's bussing around the city
with six babies on it,
on his way from girl to girl at night, emitting fumes into the atmosphere, has sex, makes a baby, bzz, goes up to the next one.
But you're so pretty in it, you're so sexy in it.
Has another baby, and you're sitting there at home. Well, my wife's worried about the climate, I guess. Well, I guess we better not have any more kids, or any kids at all.
Yeah, maybe if I fit solar panels to my house, my wife will let me have sex with her.
Buying a Prius. It's over.
I mean, they're on it. Everything they've said that we've played, which has been about 40, we've actually watched about 45 minutes of these lads. They're on it again. No one's learned anything new from them. You've been mildly entertained by me, according to Chris, Cricks. But that, you know, this stuff that the likes of you and I were talking about 6-7 years ago, you know, it was weird. We had to do it on the sly. We had to use code words. We were talking in slang. You know, we were a weird little community. We were known as the dissident right. Now, most of those people have disappeared. But this Andrew Tate and Tristan Tate are not the dissident right. These are major influencers. And that, don't, you know, look at what that word is. People take, you know, if Andrew Tate picked up the crappiest reusable drinks bottle that didn't look nice, was too expensive and kept your tea cold, it would sell 2 million that month. You know, they influence. And they're now talking about stuff that we talked about 6 years ago. This is mainstream. And I think there's something to, it's a white pill. It's a white pill. Anglo drops a Lady Godiva and he says, imagine your daughter bringing Andrew Tate to meet you. Anglo, imagine when it's in that Bugatti. You'll be like, no. You know, he's going to look after her. He's got a few quid, you know. If you said to him, I'll tell you what, if I had a daughter and Andrew Tate brought her home, I said, is this a monogamous relationship? If he said yeah, I'd say, sweet. If he said no, I'd say, ain't happening. Simple as that. I haven't got a problem with him. You know, I think everything he said on here tonight, pretty much everyone here would almost agree with. Nice one, Angler. Appreciated. You've just bought yourself an outro.
Over for you people if you don't reproduce.
Have you seen the population of Nigeria?
But I just, listen to what he said, and that is it. It's over. It's over if Western Europe don't reproduce. Jared says, I'm pretty sure he lies. Yeah, I'm sure he does. I'm sure he does. But he's also saying stuff that, you know, needs to be said, needs to be in. Hello, Broken Silence, long time no see. He says, I think the one on the left, that's Andrew Tate. Her physique has affected his ability to moderate the thermostat. Not quite sure what that means, but it's lovely to see you. Baz says, I'll give you that. I'm not sure what, but I'll take it. Oh, what, the Bugatti point, yeah. Pag says, then you'd have a grandson with no chin. He has got the old beard chin on the go. I mean, even Tristan's got a bit of a what is it? Yeah. What the worst ones, there's a lot of Arabs who do it. They've got a chinek. You know, their chin and neck is one. Have you seen them, Packer, where they leave one line, they draw their beard to distinguish between where their face ends and their neck starts? It's the weirdest optical illusion. Well, Anglo, you know, I've looked at a lot of the footage about the trial, and the girls that they're not whoring these girls. These girls they're cam girls, and if those, you know, you might have moral or ethical issues with them girls doing that, but those Bulgarian girls who will otherwise be working in a factory making pasties for like £10 a week are driving around in Beamers, like, with, you know, travel, going all around the world. They make a fortune. So, you know, I can't judge people for being involved in the sex trade. I'm engaged to a sex worker. I mean, she ain't anymore. Well, she certainly asks for a few quid occasionally. It's usually after a bit of the old, a bit of the other. Okay. Real says he's on video saying that he got him to fall in love with him. No, he's on video saying that's what the judge said. What's it called? There's a name for it, isn't there? Ah, oh, there's a name. Someone will know. Kajetel, they didn't. They didn't. There's no evidence. All the girls who the court have said have been trafficked have said, no, we weren't. They said we were offered work. We done the work. We got paid for the work. We're good friends with them. There's no evidence. Why do you think they're not in prison anymore? They're not in prison. You know, the whole case is just a joke. Do these look like two blokes that are worried that they're going to spend the next 20 years in a Bulgarian prison for sex trafficking? No, it didn't happen. And look, you could look back at my last 9 years of videos and you could clip things I've said out of context and make me look fucking terrible. Well, and there's a very good reason for that. But anyway, the point being, as I said at the beginning, Echo, my old Dr. C. Lily friend, says you can abstain from judgment, Chris, on them. More for me, these guys. Hang on, let me try and work that out. Are you talking in Dr. C. Lily code? Have I got to get to the Earth Coincidence Control Center? Yeah, I reckon they're all right. I reckon they're influencing 15 to 25-year-old Western blokes who need an antidote to the, as 42 said, to the likes of Jordan Peterson, who's a Trojan horse liberal. Jordan Peterson loves the way England's going. That's what he wants. He's a snide figure. It was 42 that put me onto that as well. He presents well, but he still hasn't told us how he got off Xanax. I'm never going to judge someone for taking drugs, but, you know, don't pretend. I know the story. I can see Xanax use all day long. Anyway, yeah, exactly, John. You know, do you know what I mean? So I made a video about it. You wanted photos. Somebody else was at Sunday time and said he was grooming Nazis. Hello, Eleanor. How are you, my love? Right, let's get back on this. Hello, Skin. How are you, son? I've just got to remember. Hang on. Skin, did you come to Cambodia? Glass Packer. Tell her one word.
Drop.
There you go. Skin, did you come out to Cambodia? You'll realise why I've asked you when I get an answer. Let's get back to the Tate brothers.
Yeah, maybe if I fit solar panels to my house, my wife will let me have sex with her.
Buying a Prius.
Hello, Al.
It's over.
It's over.
But this is a point about all this. You know, I've got friends, right, in England. And you go round their house, Skin. The reason is I sometimes confuse your name with Skin Scar. So I wasn't sure whether it was you or the other fella, but it was the other fella, Skin Scar, who came out here. So that's my apologise for my mistake. I'm getting old. But I've got friends, right, Guardian readers, and I don't let them off. It's just from the moment I arrive at their house, I'm on them. You go into their kitchen, they've probably got more plastic in their kitchen for their recycling than they're ever going to recycle. You know, the balance has already swung against their ability to recycle. And everything they do... Hello, Dax. Nice to see you, son. Someone just introduced themselves.
They did.
The next Dr. B.
Yep.
What's he say, Packer?
Hello, Dangerfield. First time on your stream.
A pleasure. Say hello to the next Dr. B, please, Scrubs. Give him a warm welcome. And I tell you, I kid you not, right? Whenever you have anything at their house, they're like, you know, should we make some snacks? Like, yeah, like, you know, we're all stoned. So it's like, yeah, all right. So we got out a bit of this, got out some, he had some foie gras, you know, the good old liberals, just stuff that fucking goose full of that fucking feed. He's all right. He's got his mouth open, isn't he? Someone else holding it open. You know, got some biscuits, got some fruit juice out. After about an hour of snacking and me taking the piss out of their ridiculous liberal lifestyle, I watched them, the two of them. It was the most disgusting domestic bliss, like Brave New World little turnout I'd ever seen. It was like a theatre of pompous, oh, what would you call it? I think I'll just go back, and it was like a pompous theatre of what's the word, a virtue. That's it. It was a pompous theatre of virtue, and they loved it. I got the feeling they got more sexually aroused doing this recycling palaver than they do when they don't have sex in their passionless swamp of a separate bedrooms, don't touch me, you haven't washed your hands relationship. I shit you not, first thing, the scissors come out. They've both got a pair. Everything needs cutting up. So the fruit juice container that I've polished off, because it was actually fruit juice I haven't had ever. They have to cut it up. Why? Because I have to clean it. Now you've got to clean that. You've got to use water to clean the inside of a fruit juice container. He's thrown that in the fucking turquoise bin. She's gone, no, Alex. I've told you before. You've got to take the lid off. The lid goes in the taupe container. And bollockless Alex, whose penis has probably gone inside and is probably likely to come out of his mouth and do a runner within the next month, he was like, oh, sorry, Miriam, sorry. I've kept their names the same to accuse the guilty. He's had to unscrew the lid, and then he chucked the box back in the turquoise. I'm not joking. It weren't like red, blue, orange. It was taupe, turquoise, magenta, cyan. I mean, what the fuck's going on? And this is like some kind of weird fever dream. He's taken the lid off, and he went, okay, so hard plastic lids are taupe. And then when he put the container back in the other one, she said, no, I just told you, Alex, the lid. He went, I've got the lid here. She said, the lid isn't just the bit you take off. There's also half the lid still on the container. Now he's nearly fucking cutting the tops of his fingers off, taking the, you know, the female thread that's on. It took him about an hour to recycle the amount of water they were using and cleaning. And I was just looking at it, and just like Tate said, I see a geezer in Cambodia today burning down the road in his like old four-stroke motor, just guzzling petrol like nobody's business, not giving a shit. Let's see. This will be interesting. Hang on. Now, I can't confirm these figures. I've just, fuck me. I'm trusting Google. I typed in, how many motor vehicles are there in India? Now, do you think these Indian motors have got catalytic converters? Do you think these are Teslas? Do you think these are hybrids? Do you think they plug them in? Do you think these are Prius? Or do you think they're knackered old scooters from 1962 that they've held together with super glue and are still managing to run with a bit of vegetable oil with a couple of litres of pink paraffin? 326 million of them burning around India all day. And old Alex and Miriam, it's humiliating. It's embarrassing. Now, don't get me wrong, if the old world done that, well, if the old world done it, they wouldn't need to do it because they wouldn't be dispensing drinks in those kinds of single-use containers anyway. But when you've got the likes of China and India just fucking farting into the atmosphere all day, every day, you chopping up a couple of... It's just emasculating. It's actually... What's a female version of emasculating? If someone can put that in the chat, I've never needed to use it. But that'll do, won't it, Otto? It's futile, yeah. It's embarrassed. Oh, look at that. Broken Silence says the tuk-tuks are two-stroke converted Lambos. I certainly knew they were two-stroke, but God, my mate's one's shit. There you go. Good call, daughter of P. Defeminized, yeah. I mean, watching the pair of them do their little recycling routine was just so... My missus is my lover. She's not even my friend. I don't want my lover to be my friend. Now, don't get me wrong. We are friends. I get that. But she's not a friend like Bally, like Paul, like Trevor. No. Because we fuck. And it's passion. And we're always on it. And that sort of semiotic interplay of seduction and desire is always going on in everything we do. The day I'm standing next to her recycling for 3/4 of an hour to save 0.00% of something that doesn't even threaten the planet, it's over. You can't have a sex life. You can't fuck someone you're doing that with. That's manual labor. It's not sexy. Manual labor's never been sexy, all right? It's jokes. And as he goes on to say here, I'll take it back a bit. Once you're doing that kind of lark, it is over. Couple of super chats. I'll get on in a minute. Thank you for those. I'll check me other. Oh, I'm checking free revenue streams. How exciting. I'll just refresh entropy. Right, here we go, people. Back to the emergency meeting of white people, Andrew and Tristan Tate. But if I haven't read your super chat, I will do.
I guess we better not have any more kids or any kids at all.
Yeah, maybe if I fit solar panels to my house, my wife will let me have sex with her.
Buying a Prius.
It's over
for you people if you don't reproduce.
Have you seen the population of Nigeria?
Right, hang on. Just to defend what I said earlier. They're brothers, right? And as I said, hello, Johnny. Hello, Neil. That was a lovely song, though, wasn't it? Let me just say this. I didn't used to like Andrew Tate, but he's growing on me. And I like relationships. I especially like relationships between blokes. I like friends. I've always had a lot of friends. I think they're important. That's why I dug out that whole thing about, oh, he's a bit gay. Then, you know, I think it's dangerous to talk to blokes about not being close. But if you don't crack a smile at this bit when they both laugh, you're never going to get them. I think this was what sold it to me. Check out the way they interact here. Just their faces and that.
Baby. Bzzz, goes up to the next one.
But you're so pretty in it. You're so sexy in it.
Has another baby. And you're sitting there at home. Oh, well, my wife's worried about the climate, I guess. Well, I guess we better not have any more kids or any kids at all.
Yeah, maybe if I fit solar panels to my house, my wife will let me have sex with her.
Buying a Prius.
It's over.
It's over for you people if you don't reproduce.
Have you seen the population of Nigeria?
It's double.
Shout out to my Nigerian brothers out here. You're doing the right thing. And let me tell you something. If Nigeria's population over the last 4 years had declined and Nigerians were not having babies, I'd be sitting here right now as a man who likes Nigerian culture and Nigerian food saying, fucking have more kids, Nigerians. But the Nigerians don't need to be told to get an erection and put it in their women. They don't need to be told. So, hey, what do you mean we cannot have more
Nigerians
kids?
Get their boners in an urgency.
Urgent Nigerian boners.
Get the work done.
Is the success of that country. You know what?
I mean, isn't it amazing? Africa is a country They're starving. They've had like so many famines, and yet they're still breeding well beyond replacement rates. And in wonderful, like, you know, oh, it's the Garden of Eden, Western Europe, the whole world wants to go there. And look at the damage they've done. They can't even get couples to breed. And I'm guilty of it. I spent my whole life thinking, I don't want kids. What the fuck do I want kids for? I'm fucking having them now, though. I'm having them now. I'm definitely having kids if it can sort it out. But, you know, I was part of that. I had a liberal arts education. I grew up in the 80s. It's an individualized society, an atomized society. Why put roots down? Why have a family? Well, I'm fucking finding out now because I live in Cambodia and I haven't got a home to go to. That's why. And it is over. Like they just said, Nigeria has doubled in its native population. And England hasn't. They're not breeding at replacement rates, just the basic replacement rates.
Who else is doing it right? The Indonesians. Nice. The Indonesians.
Nice.
You know, Muslim country. They're kind of Chinese. They're Asian. They're small. But they are fucking. And you ain't. White people.
And you know what? I'll give you a very quick overview. Because I said that the reason all these people are upset is because I said the white man's lost control of his woman.
And that's why they're mad.
That's why. And it's true because feminism has ruined society. We all know that all this liberal agendas is feminist run. We live in a matriarchy. Anyone with a brain understands that feminism's destroyed all of Western society. And
again, no one's learning anything here. Of course it has. Up with alcohol, welfare, uncontrolled immigration, and feminism. For me, they are the four horsemen of the Western Europe apocalypse. And that's not an exaggeration. A feminized education system. I've got nothing wrong with. I've got no problems with women. Obviously, I love them, but you can't bring up men in a feminized education system. It turns them stupid.
That's why they're pissed off. So I've chosen a random white person's wife to examine here. A random guy. I chose a guy, one of Ben Shapiro's best mates, called Destiny. We're gonna talk about that in a second.
How many kids does Destiny have?
I don't know how many kids his wife has, but he ain't got any. So let's look at this. And then I'm going to let you read out Destiny's messages. So this is the average white man's relationship.
I promise you it'll be equally as good. You do not need to marry someone for protection when you can just get a pet to do it. I promise you. Get good at guns. Get a dog. Dog. Yeah, someone your husband too. I don't want to feel like some pathetic loser laying in bed while my husband wakes up to like go fight someone. I'll go fight with him. We'll be the team together. Doesn't that sound a lot cooler? I would feel better about myself. He will feel more
safe. Doesn't want kids. She wants to fight intruders.
You know she divorced him, right?
Bro, this is such bullshit. If someone broke into her house, she'd fucking shit her pants. What kind of girl? This
is that me or has that gone out of sync?
This is absolute asinine garbage. That's sync. Let me tell you something from the top G. If I meet a new woman and she...
Right, hang on. I think we get the point. Listen, we've got the main bit. I'll put the link into the chat. 42 said she left Destiny when the money stopped coming in. I'll put the link in the chat if you want to watch the rest of that video. I'll stop that. I'll get my boy Pete. What's going on here? Drop that out. New comments. So what do you make of that, Pack? Have you experienced the Tate brothers before any significant amount?
Only a little dribs and drabs. I don't care for them.
You're
much.
Very loud. You're very, very loud.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I don't care for them much particularly.
What did you make of that?
I don't disagree with what they're saying. Necessarily, but I don't like the delivery.
What do you think about what I said about them and their ability to influence and their scale of their audience?
Well, obviously, it's massive, isn't it? You know, I wouldn't know how to talk to 15 to 25-year-olds. They clearly do.
I'm not going to answer that, and I'll say something stupid and get in all sorts of trouble. I've changed my tune on them. I you know, one of the things about being a YouTuber, and I'm not a very successful one, somehow it's been going for 9 years, and I love my audience. I can do a stream. I've got 165 here. We've had some new people in tonight. It's lovely. Much appreciated. Lovely to see some new people. Subscribe. Go and check out some of my writing. You might enjoy that as well. But you've also got to entertain. You know, they can't just go on their stream and say, oh, do you know? Because then it's like Sargon. And, you know, there's only so much Sargon anyone can take. Even Sargon gave up with Sargon and had to start getting the Lotus Eaters in because he knew that, fucking hell, here we go again, Carl Benjamin. And I understand. So they have got to entertain. So you're juggling with entertaining, in giving information, being informative. But they are very, very well known. Like I said, I've checked the software. I've checked the trending. They're massive. And if they're talking, they've outright said it. Unless white people start breeding at replacement rates, it's over. And, that, you know, we've all talked about the prediction from the, was he in Oxford? An Oxford professor said that white people will be a minority in the UK by 2066.
Yeah.
And you know,
they weren't massive on the family community part of that point they were trying to get across to all them young men. It was just basically just go out and have as many kids as you can, which is not.
No, but I think it's a fair point, but I do think they spoke about having a wife. And I think their main threat, I mean, that's kind of Andrew Tate's shtick, isn't it? I have loads of kids and I look up. I mean, Mumford said it to me years ago. When he said to me, he said,
"Is your girlfriend?"
Mumford said to me years ago. He said, "Is your girlfriend faithful to you?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "I absolutely require monogamy." And he sort of like looked at me like that. I said, "No, 100%. I expect all my girlfriends to be monogamous." But I that's Andrew Tate's shtick, isn't it? He's got. But someone told me he's actually got a wife and he's got a family and this is part of his shtick. Can I say that's real? Who knows? But I think it can only be a white pill when people with this amount of an audience are starting to talk about things that we talked about years ago and they're mainstreaming very simple, very basic ideas that, if they aren't mainstreamed, will disappear and take Western Europe with it. Eleanor gives me some friendly advice and says, don't jump in with both feet with the Tates, trust me. No, I haven't. I've watched them over the last few years, bits and bobs here. I don't know if you were here at the beginning of the stream, Eleanor, but I was clear to point out this isn't me saying the Tates are great. My main point is, I mean, I was entertained by a couple of blokes having a bit of banter because I like that sort of thing. But my point was they've got a massive audience and they're putting out information to that audience that is a backlash to the other information that those 15 to 25 year olds have been getting. I know they do some dodgy things. They sell shitty courses to kids that can't afford it and, you know, all sorts of things. And, you know, they run cam girls for a living. Okay, but I've used prostitutes, fucking thousands of them. So, but I think you can't deny my point that those messages are getting out to audiences far bigger than any of the dissident right got out to 5-6 years ago, Packer. Can you put them all? Never. I would suggest, what's his name, that little bloke who's my gaydar buzzes every time I see him, that little midget, sorry, small person in the suit, lives at home with his mum and dad. Far right bloke. Oh, come on. Someone in the chat will know him. Oh, come on, people. What's he called?
Has no access. Idea.
No, it's not Hitler.
Nice suit, though.
When they'd done all those Second World War in colour and everyone realised that Adolf walked around in that nice camel-coloured coat, it was a bit like, whoa. Nick Fuentes, that's it. I reckon the Tates have got a much bigger audience than Nick Fuentes. I reckon it's probably like 10 to 1 or something. So, you know, it's interesting. I don't necessarily expect you to agree with me, but I thought that was interesting. Packer, what do you make of tonight's stream? We've had good numbers, we had a laugh.
Yeah, it was, I did not say a lot, did I? It was all good. You was going all cylinders. It was all right.
I had to make up for the last one, didn't I? I nearly gave up.
I don't disagree so much with what they're saying. I'm not sure about how they're putting it across, but they're putting a better message across than the left do.
Let's see if anyone wants to come on. Someone who doesn't like the Tates. I'm going to put the link into the chat. I'm only going to take one person on at a time, and I'm only going to probably have one guest because I've been here for 2.5 hours now. Although, you'd be surprised what a grift would do. Look at Packer already smiling, knowing. Packer, if it's going on too long, mate, you can always dip out. Don't go anywhere, though, because I can't. Hang on. Echo reckons Milo reckons he's straight now. No way has he prayed the gay away. What a terrible shame. Be gay if you're gay. I've always liked the gays. I've never had a problem with them. They're quite good at helping straight blokes. I mean that. I really mean that. You know, they really helped me out of my style when I was the only straight in the village. What, naked? Is that your joke, Packer? You can understand why a gay might like my style. I'll put the link in the chat there. Someone who doesn't like the Tates and would like to come on and explain why, that might be quite interesting. Wait, John, my mate, King of the Gays, Ivan Masso, he done that for a laugh. Like, he's proper, he's 42. It had to be, didn't it? Look, he's going to start shilling his channel. Packer, as soon as he mentions his channel, yeet him, and I'll blame technology. Oh, fuck, he's probably listening. Hello, mate.
Packer, what about you, lads?
All right.
Oh, good. How's yourselves?
All good.
Oi, 42. Me and Packer are like a couple of naughty schoolboys all of a sudden. I'm not quite sure why.
Because I was backstage and heard you talking about me.
I knew you were, though. That's why.
Yeah.
No, oi, Packer told me, he said to me, you got to check out 42's stream with our pal going off on one or something. And I haven't yet, so I will.
Yep. That one had to get moved to BitChute because I don't think it would have survived on YouTube.
Packer is advertising. He's advertising.
You asked me a question and I had the answer.
Oh, he did as well. All right, no worries. I'll check that out. Have you set up your pay shoot yet?
What, my pay shoot? What's that? Like a PayPal type thing?
On BitChute, you can now monetize it there, and you can name them whatever you want. Now, someone who may or may not be the bloke who owns BitChute suggested Super Shekels, but I, for instance, I've really just got him in trouble there, haven't I? Like, I could call mine like scrub vouchers or something, do you know what I mean? Or like grift tokens, you call them what you want. I think that's quite cool, but it's a maze of like, what? And I said to the bloke who runs it, I went, I'd love to stream on your platform. I can't work it out. You could help us just do it. And he just done it. I was like, wicked.
So I have a policy on...
Sorry, 42. Sorry, 42. I just want to say that Guy Division says, I was helped by a gay twice, memorably. Yeah. There you go. You see? Gays do help. Right. Carry on talking about your stream.
I have a policy on monetization. I think that people should if they wish to, but it's not for me.
Whoa. That doesn't reflect well on me, does it?
No, it don't. No, here, Chris, I'll be honest with you. See what you do. I think you really should be grifting. I think people, everybody that's in the chat, give them a wee £1 or something or whatever, buy somebody a membership or whatever. But I honestly think you should, but it's just not for me.
Fucking hell, he's got other people waving his flags now. Look, all right. Jesus
Christ. They are really good, though, Chris.
I know, and I'm fucking glad, though. I love the lad. I tell you what, 42 has been a dream and a pleasure since he came over here. Asdak, mate, that, well, it's only jokes, man. Come on, we know that.
Yeah.
We know. I wouldn't expect anyone to go without to give me something. If you can, make sure you definitely do. That's all right. That's my stance on it. 42, that's interesting, though. I mean, we're going slightly off track. Why? Yep. What, you don't think you deserve people donating to you?
Here, Chris, I'll send you an email about it because it's not really, it's not, why I make those choices isn't really for public consumption, but you're somebody that I could explain that to you.
42's a secret billionaire. I can't accept your fiver, sorry. I'm sitting on a seat of gold. No, fair play. We won't go down there if you've got a reason.
Yeah, I'll tell you something. It's the exact same reason why I think that a lot of Andrew Tate's stuff shouldn't be monetized. But
Okay. Right. So what, are you talking about the likes of this video with his Rumble channel, for instance?
Right. Yeah. Well, see, Andrew and Tristan Tate primarily make their money from courses that they sell to socially awkward young males.
Yep.
And most of those people have nothing.
And the same amount of those people ain't going to make anything out of those courses.
It's a common problem with the PUA, pickup artist community. And the supposed manosphere, which really doesn't exist, they lumped men's rights advocates in with pickup artists and
42. Who did that? Did the liberal media do that intentionally?
Liberal media did that.
Right. Okay. Carry on. This is cool. So this is interesting.
People like myself that are they class themselves as a MRA, which stands for Men's Rights Advocate. We're not activists. We advocate for better resources for males.
Right.
As opposed to being an activist who is someone who goes out in the street. You've got pickup artists who primarily make their money by selling books, courses, and public appearances to socially awkward young men who have nothing. And I honestly think that taking from people that you know have nothing is deplorable.
I think if you're providing a service that's entertaining, I think, you know, you can watch, and there are people who've been watching my streams for 8 or 9 years and they've never given anything, and they're still, I don't rank anyone, but makes the Tates, hang on, I think I'm actually going to agree with you. What makes the Tates thing unpleasant, at least unpleasant, is they're not only selling them something, it's also a dream, isn't it? No, go on, get that last bit of money together because you're going to be a millionaire once you've done our course. And then when it doesn't work, oh no, you need to buy step two. You need to buy the booster. Yes. It's almost like the vaccine. You know, you need to buy the next, and it's an ongoing. And
well, here's the other really big glaring problem. See, whenever you started your channel, Chris, you never went out with a target audience, possibly with the exception of people who already enjoyed your comedy.
Yeah.
Whereas the likes of the Tates find a target audience of needy people that could really do with some very basic advice that you can do for free and set about monetizing that constituency.
So you're suggesting, and I'm going to find out why you think this. You're suggesting they It wasn't organic. They sat down with potentially a group or maybe just him and his brother, and they thought, how can we make a load of money online? And they came up with selling courses to make money, because there's loads of people who do that. Is that what you're suggesting?
The Tate business model started off as a large house where he got a bunch of cam girls into the house, okay, and they had their show scheduled, jump, 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 and then would bring the one that's coming on next 10 minutes before into the studio where the previous one was doing, say, hello, it's my friend, she's going to be on 10 minutes, blah, blah.
So they keep...
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Right. Then they began to have problems with their cam girl, not their market, but their business structure. And they needed to branch out to wider people. And they picked the people they decided to go for as a new target audience was...
But 42, isn't that capitalism? Isn't that offering a service that you want people to buy?
Right, yep.
If you're what you're doing, and I'm not saying you're wrong, but you're suggesting that these young men don't have a choice.
Well, see, here's the
and
thing.
And also, I understand marketing. You know, you can sell absolute shit if you do it correctly. And then you get that, you know, there's a whole thing about ethical marketing, which I try and stick to. You know, if I do a sale, I want you to get something decent at a discount. I'm not going to try and stitch you up and just say, oh, 50% off stuff that was twice this price, you know, 5 weeks ago. So it's actually back to its normal price.
Yeah, but I totally get that. And it's fair enough. That's how you want to go about running your business. That's fine. However, a better version of all the advice that young men are getting from the Tates is available for free in many other places. I'll tell you about that. See any young man that has any form of dilemma about, just go on to, you can look up Asshole Consultant on YouTube. Stick it whenever Aaron Clary's thing comes up, look through it, and there'll be a video where a very similar problem has been discussed, and you can just watch that and get that shit for free.
Now, 42, academic agent, he sells courses on the internet.
Yep.
They're quite expensive as well.
Yep.
And it's information you can get off the internet.
Right.
You can just, because it's a... It's a library, isn't it, the internet? Right. You can get that information.
As does Aaron Clary, and his courses on minimalism or anything are quite expensive, but he puts that price on it because he reckons that if somebody's going to actually follow the information, then they've had a upfront cost. However, he also has all of his stuff there for free. My bigger issue is probably that governments, government agencies, the education system, for whatever reason, decided to go on a war with the Tates, which drove all the traffic to them, which puts the Tates between the people that... people who think like me want to talk to, and those people.
So hang on, this is important. For people who don't know, 42 used to be really, really a part of the MRA, the Men's Rights Advocate Movement, and actually affected real change, like letters to government, meetings with government, and you know, knows his stuff inside out. We had a couple of cracking streams. We've still got to do the Jordan Peterson one. And it was your little tip on that one that made me see him from a different angle. But can I just ask you, that's a great point you've made there. So the Tates are now almost like a smokescreen between people who could, like yourselves and the other serious MRAs, and the people who need that content, who could do with that information.
The two people between the people we need to help and us are the Tates and Peterson.
Yeah, I thought you were going to say that.
And they've both been put there by governments, NGOs and whatnot.
So you think this is all intentional, the fact that they got locked up, the exposure? Because it's a marketing. Oh, I would love to be marketed like, chuck me in prison for a couple of weeks. If I'm going to get this amount of people watching my channel, I'll do it. I mean, it does look fantastic. And they don't come across like people who've been in prison for 6 months. I'm not saying they weren't, but...
No, one more thing. Right.
One more thing, because this is really... Is this something that is being discussed at the moment in the men's rights... What was the word you used? I don't want to get it wrong.
Yeah, men's rights advocacy, MRS.
Is this a thing that is being discussed at the moment, the fact that the Tates are almost controlled opposition?
The big discussion about the Tates happened probably 3 to 4 years ago. And the discussion was, who the fuck are these people?
Thanks.
Because nobody knew who they were. They had a very small, outside of the porn world, they had a very small footprint until the Western world decided to teach children in school that they were given a bad message. And so that's when they grew up.
So I know you stepped back a bit from the MRA, and understandably, because it's fucking stressing and you put a lot of your life into it. I get that. No judgment there at all. Respect to what you've done. So what, it must be kind of weird for, you keep in contact with these people, I'm sure. It must be very strange now that you were discussing this 3 years ago and you've just watched them blow up. And it's like,
We all knew what was going to happen 4 years ago.
Wow.
We could have wrote this, put it this way, see Jordan Peterson.
Yeah.
A really, really interesting thing. Before he had his big argument in university with the pupils, students, nobody knew who he was.
That was the original, use your pronouns outside, right. Wasn't it?
Yes. Yeah. No, but... And my two questions on that was, how did this get around the world as fast as it did? And secondly, if he's genuinely a professor who was obviously not talking to his own students, he was talking to students that went to that college but not in his class. If he's going to debate with students, why does he not do it in a lecture theatre with a Q&A or with the thing worse controlled? Why is he standing shouting at students in basically a corridor?
I mean, I'm having a little bit of trouble. I mean, I'll believe anything, but are you suggesting that was curated?
Oh, yeah. The clue should have been that there was that there was perfect audio and... and close-ups from several angles,
which you don't usually get, do you? When it's actually something beautiful, when it's actually something really gritty, it's like an iPhone in a crowd.
If it's real, that doesn't happen. You had video from several angles. You had audio quality that was standard right away across it.
But would you not get that in the modern world with phones? No. Everyone's got them.
No. Oh, God, no. Oh, God, no, you don't. You put up a phone to record something and something like that, and you've got the gibbering from the person right and left of you. Everything fights for
dominance, doesn't it? Yeah, I've got it making shorts and that. So are you suggesting that, and I'm not, I don't want to put words in your mouth, did Peterson know that he was part of this? Was it like...
Of course he did.
What, with a professional marketing team or an NGO or something? Was it like, let's...
I'm not sure who put it together, but I can tell you this for a fact. The men's rights movement was gaining people at a phenomenal rate. And suddenly, all the people who had been coming into the men's rights movement, the likes of A Voice for Men, Exposing Feminism 2.0, all those places, everybody that then started coming in, that then ended up at Jordan Peterson. Because he was
buying it.
Yeah.
So that's really interesting. I'm having a little bit of the sound thing. I mean, there could have been a student who was a YouTuber at a directional mic.
All right. Well, please explain this. Jordan Peterson does sell out tours to 500 people in an auditorium a night. He's never been banned from anywhere, with the exception of a slight problem in Australia because of who he was there with. And whenever AVFM tried to have the first conference for international men's issues, which was like 18 months previous to that, they had to change venues at the last minute because they got threatened with bombs.
It's weird, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
When was I can't remember her name, and I apologize. She made the movie The Red Pill, which just before Peterson's kind of explosion on the scene.
Cassie J made that film. She did the filming in 2014 because that was at the conference in Detroit. Then everybody that she normally went to fund her post-production said, no, we're taking nothing to do with this.
Because she, the reason I bring that up, if you don't know the movie The Red Pill, she was a feminist and she wanted to look into the men's rights movement. She called it that, I think, at the time. And she said, you know, they get a lot of bad press. And as a feminist, I think it's only right I look at the other side. And interestingly, through the process of making that documentary, she kind of dropped feminism, and that's where people getting red-pilled. That's where that idiom comes from, isn't it? Red-pilled.
I think Cassie picked that because the red pill was already very heavily used in the men's rights movement.
Well, wasn't it? It's from the Matrix originally,
it came from the Matrix films, but I got involved with the men's rights movement in 2012, and from day one I found it, there was the red pill stuff, and it had been there for many years.
Okay, I'm just checking that none of the super chats are referring to what you're saying, because that would be important. They are not. So I must admit, he's had an easy ride of talking and selling out everywhere he goes.
Yeah,
and he's not on our side. A lot of people thought he was.
And he wrote the foreword. He wrote part of the foreword for Agenda 21, and he said himself that his job was to change the thinking of millions of young men.
And he's not a collectivist, is he?
Well,
he doesn't believe in collectivism.
His aim is to drag all men back onto the provide and protect plantation.
I mean, it's almost, you know, I'm kind of playing devil's advocate, but I also tend to agree. But, you know, tidy your room is a little bit like, no, go and make some movements happen. Don't sit at home. Tidy your room, you fucking idiots. Yeah.
if you actually read that book, you'll get to chapter 3 where Jordan Peterson states, I am a compulsive liar. I don't know if I have told the truth or a lie, but I do say what I know people need to hear. However, I can normally ferret out the lie.
I can kind of, as a writer, I can kind of go with that.
Yeah, but here's the thing, Chris. You're not basing your whole career on, I'm going to tell people how to put their shoulders back and fly right.
No, it's not. I don't write political stuff. No, yeah. No, that's a fair, good point. Good point.
Yeah, but it's right. Put your shoulders straight, fly right, everything will be fine. By the way, I'm a compulsive liar. Those two things don't jive together.
No, and you, I'm not so convinced on the sound thing, but the fact that he's had almost no trouble touring the world, even very low down people saying the right things, you know, Cassie J had it, didn't she? We're going to bomb that theater, and they stopped it being shown, didn't they?
They actually got her. Cassie J had it booked into enough theaters to make the Red Pill movie eligible for the Oscars, and because you have to have had a certain amount of live screenings to be eligible for the Oscars, and the feminists caused enough problems for enough of those to be cancelled that it was no longer eligible for the Oscars. How it finished up in the end was, if you were going to a screening of a Red Pill, you paid for your ticket and you were told the basic area of what
like the old days, going to a rave, you had to wait under a bridge somewhere.
you got a text message half an hour before to say which theater it was in.
42, both you and I know this is the third stream we're still yet to do. So
yeah,
get that email to me. You don't have to explain your position on Super Chats. That's fine. That's if private, you know, I have a private life as well as a public life. But let's get that done. I've also got to do, I'm with Rags and Jack. 42, I'll let you go now. Incredible input at the end there. Nice little something to think about.
I've got about 30 seconds on Milo for you.
Go for it.
Milo decided that he wasn't gay anymore.
That's what someone said.
Right, yeah, but he's also doing a lot of work to try to get people away from gay. Milo's current position is he ended up gay because it was a fashion thing, and also fueled on drugs and alcohol, and he did a lot of stuff on that was destroying his life, and he changed.
Where do you stand on Milo? Figuratively, I mean.
Yeah, probably on his throat, but that.
Okay, that says enough.
I don't know. He has his uses, but I think he's a bit disingenuous.
It was a bit weird when he turned up with old Ye and that at the Tim Pool thing, wasn't it? When he went, I'll go out and have a look, make sure he's all right. Do you remember that? The Tim Pool podcast?
No,
I
don't remember. I didn't see that one.
I'll try and dig it out. I won't. I'll completely forget as soon as I finish this sentence.
Yeah.
You've dropped some massive bombs. Let's get this damn stream done. I know it'll be brilliant. I just don't like planning streams.
Yeah.
when that day comes, I'm like, oh, fucking hell, man. I can't be asked, especially that gibbering wreck 42, but you always are amazing. Look at Packer, that caused him to raise an eye there. He knows I can talk to him like that. He's my best mate, 42. Look after yourself, mate. You've put a spanner in the works of my entire stream, you bastard.
Well, thanks very much for having me on. Always a pleasure. And talk soon.
No, amazing. Cheers, 42. Ta-da. Yes, 42, Packer. Look what he done right at the end. I've just spent 2¾ hours trying to say that there's a bit of value with those lads. He's come on.
He's put a bit more thought into it than you, I think.
Oh, you've
been all over it a lot longer.
You cheeky bastard. He's cleverer than me and he's brighter. More intelligent, essentially.
No.
You've done well. Joking aside, I'm glad he'd give us that information. But what I said at the beginning was, this isn't about what I feel about Andrew Tate. And I want people to remember this again. And I've said it a few times. They've got a hell of a lot of influence. And the things they said on that video will get to a lot of people. Now, I think what 42 is suggesting is other stuff are going to come with it. There's a super chat here where Mikey P, thank you, Mikey, says Tate cheers on the building of mosques. Yeah, he's a Muslim. So, yeah, there's that, which has done incredible damage to Western Europe. But I think in the stream, he would suggest, I think to be consistent with the message of that stream, he would say Western Europe have allowed them to do that. And ideally, they wouldn't. I don't know that for sure. But my point being, I'll put the link again to the whole video so that you can watch it without me interrupting in there. And I think millions of people are going to, of young men, are going to know now about the potential, I've got to be careful here, of demographic replacement in Western Europe. And there you go. I'll go through these super chats. There's a couple that come in. Don Anglo's one. Misses me in it. Looks like I have to pay you now to. Oh, there's been 160 people, and I'm trying to talk and listen. Have you been watching Shogun, Misses me in it? Has anyone been watching Shogun? Best bit of television I've ever seen.
Brilliant, isn't it?
I know I bang on about the culture industry, but there's been a glitch in the culture industry matrix. And the new Shogun, and I mean this, people, it's the best television ever made. Not a little bit better. It's a standout, superior piece of entertainment. And like when I say I liked Reacher, I liked Reacher just to sit there and passively consume it. If you go to YouTube and type in something like Shogun Episode 7, you'll see about 100 channels with like 2-3 million subscribers doing like interpretations, readings, reviews, because it's so nuanced and subtle. It's like what I always talk about with literature. You don't sit there passively consuming it. You have to work. You have to join dots. They don't do it all for you. You are actively involved in the production of meaning. What the story of Shogun is work made by the people who made the show and your bonds. And the dialectic of those two things together is the story. And it's next fucking level. I'm going to come back to you, Mrs. Me, in it. Because Packer just said it's excellent. So you're up to date with it, are you?
Yeah, yeah.
What do you make of it?
It's brilliant. It's really good. I'm looking forward to see how it all pans out.
Oh, there's only one episode left. So for people who don't know, I never usually do this once a week because people don't watch telly like that anymore. And it's been a pain in the ass. I watched the first one, I was just like, wow. I am talking from the detail of the costumes. You know, I watched a documentary about it afterwards because I was just thinking, hang on, someone had to make all those costumes. The costume room is the size of like a sports hall. And the designer was sort of saying, yeah, we had to go back, look at the history books, look at old paintings and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, their clothes are multi-layered. It's not just, I'll stick a kimono on them. They're all wearing like 5 or 6 layers like they would. The quality of the acting is... The storytelling is, I'm embarrassed that the culture industry has managed to, it's almost like a mirror of what 42 just said about Tate, because it almost makes people start trusting telly again. It's fucking great. So if you haven't seen it, wait till Tuesday. Definitely don't download the whole, there'll only be one season because it's based on James Clavell's book. Definitely don't download all 10 episodes because that's illegal. It's fucking brilliant. I mean, did you see your... Let's not do any spoilers, Packer.
Yeah, I did,
The end of the last episode. I reckon, because millions of people around the world are watching it, it's already a success. I reckon there was a communal gasp. Like, I just went, oh, and never saw it coming. And that takes balls to do what they've done there. I don't want to ruin it for anyone, but, you know, like main characters. I'm sure you probably thought the same as me, how that would turn out. And, well, that ain't going to happen now, is it?
No.
I was just like, fuck. And then when the credits come up, I was like, oh, God. Like 7 days is so long. Yeah, people, it's a tip for you. If you do look for it on the internet, make sure you put Shogun 2024. I don't want anyone to go looking for it. Find the 1980s version and come back to me and go, I don't know about that, mate. No, it's been made like last year. But it's something else. Does the missus like it, Pac, or is it like a family deal?
No, she's not into it. No, my daughter's watching it. She put me onto the main bloke, Cosmo, whatever his name is.
Yeah, Cosmo Jarvis.
He was a musician.
Like one of the best actors I've ever seen.
Well, he was a musician, quirky, interesting songs. But look him up. There's one about gay pirates or something.
I will look him up, but
he's queer. Well, Chris, I think he's queer.
Well, as I've already said, I don't give a shit about the gay.
Same as Chamberlain.
But with me and culture, if I see, hear, or read something and think I can do it, I'm not interested because I can do that. If I hear a bit of music and I can think, okay, yeah, give me a couple of hours, I could do that. But I can't act. I can't act to save shit. You know the stories of all the auditions I went on when I was a comedian, and I just haven't got the chops to act. But his character is immediately believable, and it's a very weird character.
Yeah.
It's not like, you know, you want it. You think he's going to be this kind of archetypal warrior figure who's going to sort of go, "You can't keep me here. I'm English." But he's sort of he's sort of a little bit odd, isn't he? He's like this quirky. He's not your sort of standard leading man. Nice. It's amazing. Anyway, 42 drops and bombs, people. Look out for the stream. We will do it. It's been 2 years, I think, since we've done the other two. But me and 42 is going to come on and dish the full dirt on Jordan Peterson. And just those couple of bombs he dropped there make a lot of sense. It's given me some information to not reevaluate the tapes, because my point was just what they talked about in that episode. But it is interesting. You know, most OG scrubs will remember when I asked what controlled opposition was. I didn't understand what it was. But there's two very good examples. If 42's right, then Jordan Peterson and the Tates, certainly Jordan Peterson and maybe the Tates, are controlled opposition. And it's the most dangerous kind of opposition, because you buy it. Oh, God, I hope Shogun's not controlled opposition. Oi, 42, is Shogun all right? can we enjoy Shogun? Mrs. Me in it, bless you, darling. Looks like I have to pay you now to acknowledge my existence. I hope you got the shed load of angel delight. Darling, I haven't. What happens is I only get parcels when it's work stuff. So... Oh, that's a nasty comment. Look, she's paid and she said, "I'm not acknowledging her existence," and saying, "Did you get the massive load of things you told me you loved?" I'm sorry if you feel like I've missed you out, darling, but it's just been busy, you know. But sorry, love. I'll make it up. I will make it up to you and I'll find a way out. Every stream now, I'm going to mention you. Every message you put on the screen. Actually, I'm not going to do that. Actually, because that won't affect you at all. You'll just be like, "Right, oh, I like this. This is great fun." But I apologize if you felt like I ignored you. I certainly didn't do it intentionally. Thank you for the donation. And when the angel delights arrive, I will delightfully enjoy them in an angelic way. And I will be thinking of you and I will thank you. Helps out, Packer. I feel bad now.
He's probably been stopped at customs because he's always powder being sent to Chris Dangerfield. And they're like, "Hang on, hang on."
Yeah. You want to see the amount of powder being sent from Chris Dangerfield? How do you think I'm paying my rent at the moment? LC350 dropped an air and Senna. My entropy don't work. There's a cheeky ribeye at the moment. I'll get 2 ribeyes for that. Thank you, LC350. Machano Capricionata Tutu. Gutted entropy didn't work. I'm going to have a word with those boys because that is my preferred platform. And if it's not working, that's stupid. And we get no VARTs. What happened to the VARTs? Thank you, LC350. And thank you for, when it didn't work on Entropy, giving it a pop on here. Manny Moo drops a 5-spot, even though I question climate change. That shows a brave man with courage, class, and decorum. You agree with me there, Becca?
Yeah.
There you go. Echo says, Chris, is Sam Hyde on your comedy radar? Yeah, without a doubt. What an anomaly. But I'm now starting to question everything that's being allowed. Yeah, from the TED Talk as the Roman Centurion to the Adult Swim. Yeah, incredible. He's the best one. You've just said it. The paradigm shift. Let me read your comment. Thanks for the air and center. Is Sam Hyde on your comedy radar? He's still active, but the best intro is something from 2014 called 2070 Paradigm Shift. Glorious skewering of utopian idealism would be a fun future react. Good call, Echo. So most of you will know Sam Hyde. He does a TED Talk. Lord knows how he got it, probably off the back. He had a TV series. He actually had, it's like a Adult Swim. Help us out, Echo. Million Dollar Club or something. I can't remember. And he knocked it on the head in the end because they were telling him what to do. Sam Hyde is a legitimate, I'm doing what I want. And that's how it's going to go. Right? Really, he's a loose cannon. Like, no one, I don't know how he's got where he has, which is now making me think he's controlled opposition like the rest of them. 42, you've ruined my life. No Shogun, no Samide. But there's one thing he done. Oh, what's the other YouTuber's name? Echo, you'll know it. iDubbbz. Listen to this, people. I'm sure I told you before. But iDubbbz wants to do a documentary about Sam Hyde. Do you know this, Packer?
Nope.
iDubbbz is a very big YouTuber, but he's very middle of the road, like, you know, just rubbish. You know, he got a very big channel, very successful in the early days of YouTube, and, you know, that deserves some kind of congratulations, but it's not my stuff. It's probably for, like, 15-year-old girls go, I love iDubbbbz. He asked Sam Hyde if he could do a documentary about Sam Hyde and his, like, comedy. So Sam Hyde says yes. So iDubbbbz turns up. And Sam Hyde has got like this studio where he's got all his mates working on computers. He's got his girlfriend there who's like this meth addict, smoking meth, with like half her head shaved off. And Sam Hyde just abuses her. He just sort of walks past her and sort of puts a kick in and sort of tells her to shut up and like screams at her and thinks, shut up, you fucking idiot. And like sends her out to get her stuff. And she can barely string two words together. And then iDubbbz is like, okay, so what's this? And Sam's like, well, this is where we put together the music. And this bloke turns around and he's like, we do raps, like hip hop, like beats and stuff. And iDubbbz is just like, wow. And then they go out and drive this weird car. I mean, it's a while since it's fucking weird, right? And iDubbbz is there for about 5 days. And it's the weirdest documentary you've ever seen. On the last day, I don't know if I should tell you, actually. Go and watch it. Go and find it. Ah, fuck it. I'll ruin it for you. Sam Hyde is lying. The whole thing is a setup. They're not his workers or his staff. That's not his girlfriend. He just got a studio, hired loads of actors, and just done a fake life. So iDubbbz goes down there, spends 5 days with him, filming loads of it, editing it and all that, thinking, wow, this is really weird. And on the last day, Samai just goes, nah, it's all lies. No. Every single thing you videoed is just, we just done it for a laugh. And iDubbbz is like, what, it's just not real. And Samai's like, no, it's just a bit of fun. It's really awkward, man. It's amazing. And Sam Hyde's really like that. He just goes, nah, there you go. So maybe you should go home now. It's beautiful. So, yes, I am aware of Sam Hyde. Lord knows out. He's still there. Anglo saying 42 streams are excellent. Yeah, I'm going to watch the one 42. If you're still here after dropping those bombs, can you ping me the link to the stream that Packer's talking about? Packer, what one is it? Or does Anglo? Does
it's the one? He's put it on BitChute, and it's the one with the RPAL.
Is he still here? 42. If you're still here, let me know in the chat. Yeah, good call, Toffee. Sorry, Toffee. I haven't said hello to you, I don't think. Yeah, because he's blurred. So Toffee's saying that Sam Hyde reminds him of Andy Kaufman. If you don't know Andy Kaufman, what he'd done was blurred the line between who he was and the comedian. And you never knew really what was going on. And, you know, he used to fight that wrestler and no one ever... Yeah, it's a good call, actually. There's no point me talking about it now, because if you don't know Sam Hyde or Andy Kaufman, you'll probably not get it. There you go. Nice one, 42. I'll appreciate that. I'll watch that like as soon as this stream's finished, which is it is about to. Well, there you go. Johnny says it's called A Response to Davos with 42 and Al Mac. Sweet. I recommend other people to watch that as well. I've been heard it's good. Wolfie, yep, it's what's his name? Old face pulling man plays Kaufman, doesn't he? What's his name? Made a
Jim hole. Carrey.
That's it. Jim Carrey plays Kaufman, doesn't he? Oh, no, Johnny, you've been called out there, son. You've got it wrong. Bloggs is in. He says he doesn't sex. Sam Hyde doesn't sexually abuse men who pass out drunk around him. I don't know what that means, but. I don't know what that means. Packer, can you help us out? Nice to see you, Bloggs.
I don't know who does.
Incredible bit of niggling, though, like straight on it. Like,
yeah. I thought Cricks, what was his name?
Cricks. You thought that might have been Bloggs in disguise.
I did, yeah, yeah. After the like the second or third thing he said, I thought he's a fucking that's Billy.
Yeah, I didn't know what to say. Hello, VC. I'm not sure if I've said hello to you either. There's some other things Sam Hyde has done. There's a really famous little clip of him, and I think it's from his TV show, Millionaires. I can't remember what it's called. I'm sure Dr. C. Lilly, OCCO, has put it in the chat. But his brother doesn't like his new missus. Ah, we can probably get away with watching it, actually. Hang on. This will be a great end to the stream, people. Thank you. We've still got 140 people here. This will be a good end to the stream. If I get yeeted, we'll call it a day. But it's very early Sam Hyde. But I would advise people who like their comedy. You can't predict what's going to happen, and Sam Hyde won't let you. He doesn't want you to. He doesn't want you to be able to. It's fucking hard to explain, man. It's fucking hard. I'm trying to find this one scene, but this is very If you search for iDubbbz documentary, you can find that. I've got it. You just tricked my wife. Right, this is 2 minutes, 16 seconds. This is Sam Hyde years ago, but it's proper brutal. Trigger warning because it's YouTube. This is quite brutal, but it's on YouTube, so it should be all right. Have a look at this. But this is Sam Hyde's not really like this now, but it gives you an idea of the seedling, the germination stage of Sam Hyde. No worries, Jones James, I will be on that. I know there's a few more. Let's have a look at this. But yeah, if you like your comedy out of control, but what I will warn you about Sam Hyde, he'll let you down in the end, because as soon as he's got an audience that like what he does, he'll change, because that's not his thing. It's an interesting angle. Anyway, here we go. Check this out. Ah, balls. I forgot to put the audio on. But this was the first thing I ever saw of Sam Hyde's, and I just thought, oh, my gosh, this geezer, I need to look further into this. And I haven't stopped since. Here we go.
though. I tell you what, that cheese we tried that I liked, couldn't figure out what it was. It was Swiss.
That's Sam Hyde, the bloke talking now with the Hitler haircut.
Couldn't figure out what it was. It was Swiss cheese.
Well, it's been a pretty good night. It's been fun enough. I like hanging out with my brother. I like hanging out with my brother's wife, even though she is what she is.
Nick, she's got an associate's degree. I know you may think she's just a hot little package, but she's educated. I love her forever, no matter what. Isn't that right, babe?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot to love. You guys make me sick when I look at you, but it's not because of you, because you're my brother and I love you. It's this dog of a woman that you married.
Choose your words carefully, big guy. This is my wife you're talking about here. Let me tell you what we're going to do. Me and Amber, we got a new tandem bicycle. We're going to go up to New Hampshire, tool around on that. You bring Zarnubius. Tandem bicycles are good, okay?
I'm getting more wine.
No, help yourself. $36 a bottle. Please, enjoy it.
Nick, what's going on, big guy? You just tripped my wife.
Brother, I'm not going to invite you over to my beautiful home. Have a wine party so I can throw your wife through a table.
Nick, we're talking about my wife here, for Christ's sake. You just tripped her. I watched you do it with my own two feet.
Do you really want to sit here and go through the rigmarole?
Nick, my wife's laying here bloodied and bashed. Come on. You tripped her, Nick.
She can say whatever she wants, but I didn't trip your wife. I didn't trip you. You fell.
When my field hockey wife asked me to marry her, I said yes. And I made a vow that day to stand behind her. So you don't go tripping her.
You're going
to
sit here and point fingers at me, and she's going to crawl around on my $1,900 rug, bleeding from her eye sockets and trying to tell me that I shoved her through a goddamn table? You're fucking crazy as she is.
I think you're right.
You owe me $2,000.
However many times I watch it, it's just fucking brilliant. Yep, it's brutal, but honestly, whoa. I can't explain how weirder it's got. That's got to be 10 years ago, and someone put it up on the screen. I think it was My Man 22 Hours. That's it. That was a TV series called Million Dollar Extreme. Yeah, man, that's incredible. You owe me $2,000. What do you make of that, Packer?
Yeah, odd. Yeah, I didn't see that coming. The jokes you don't see coming are funnier, aren't they?
Yeah. They certainly are. Right. A couple more super chats to get through. I'll just check entropy and I'll go over it. Okay. We done Mikey P's. Well, Mikey P dropped another one. He said, this stream of theirs is a gloat. So he's talking about the Tate stream. Oh, yeah. So you're suggesting, Mikey, that they're gloating that white people have lost because of. You're taking that angle on it. Okay, that's interesting. That would be the controlled opposition sort of angle. Okay, no, fair point. Something to think about. Jones James says, see Scrumpy Monkey for info on containment. Okay, see Scrump Monkey for info on containment. The Petersons of this world are sent to absorb dissenting energy, dispersing it harmlessly into the ether. Yeah, that's your controlled opposition angle, isn't it? So they're, like 42 said, just as the men's rights movement looked like it was blowing up, Peterson arrives, takes the eyes off of something that had been going for a long time and had an actual agenda, and then just had it a bloke sitting about tidying up your bedroom and selling hundreds of millions of dollars worth of books. And another one, which is the same book he wrote again. Nice one, mate. Good call. So if anyone wants to look at containment, check out Scrump Monkey. I've never heard of him myself, but I'll check it out. Anglo said, I can't get entropy to work either, mate. I'm going to have a work. I know the people who run entropy. I said, what a terrible shame. So I would assume that no one can if two people can't. It's a bit of an assumption, but Little Red's been poorly again, but Dangerfield always there. Little Red, not poorly like you were before, because you were very poorly. Have you just been a bit sick? Well, that might be a bit dark. I won't go into the details, but I just hopefully you got a cold or something is what I mean. I didn't really know how to handle human conversation then for a minute, Packer. I sort of fell apart. Good Lord. Have I missed anyone super chat?
Did I finish Mrs. Minutes, or is she going to go? There was a couple that didn't say anything, I think.
Oh, yeah, there was a super sticker. No, John Manny Moo. Thank you, John.
Yeah, and Dave's Waffle House. Look.
And Dave's Waffle House. Well spotted. Cheers, Dave. Cheers, Monty Moo. What are you giggling at, Packer? Share it with me.
I know who Dave's Waffle is.
Oh, I do as well. He's got his own channel.
He's not here now. It's because he's streaming. He's already gone.
I'll wrap this up then.
No, don't worry. This
is gaslighting. Oh, 22 hours. Look at Packer. He's having his own show here. The group is Million Dollar Extreme. The show was well pleased. Thank you, 22 hours. I clearly didn't know, but I just knew a few words. But people, check out Sam Hyde. It's like sometimes he just rings people up and just screams at them. And then by the end of the call, you realize it was someone offering him a television show that he doesn't want. Who turns down a television show? It's incredible. 42 says you can skip about the first half hour of every stream I've ever made because it's just me fumbling and mumbling and barely being able to string a sentence together. Nice one, 42. Hello, Al. Did I actually say hello to you? I have now. Al's been on the firm for 40 months. Chris, you still got the Island Boys vid. I have somewhere. I'm wondering. I'll dig it out and I'll why are you asking that? That's what you need it. You need it. Did you get a bit fixated? Oh, 22H reckons his entropy went through. Yeah, it did. 22H. Oh, not only did he use the old Packer, can you indicate the Buy Me a Beer QR code? There you go. You got it first time now. But he also proved that entropy is working. Nice one, 22 hours. World Peace 2 coming this year. There's a new Sam Hyde show season, is there? Amazing. Okay, Anglo is shilling John Davison's stream later. There you go. Maybe see you there. I won't because it's 3 o'clock in the morning and I was up at 6 this morning. 22 hours, has been a member for 8 months. Thanks for being on the firm. Echo's itching for more Dragon's Den reacts and maybe a shimmy to the Shark's Tank. So one of my subscribers sent me, he's my Dragon's Den dealer, really. He sends me the cool ones because I don't like watching them first. But if I don't watch them first, it can be a waste of time and a lot of time, like 40 minutes. And then halfway through, I'm just like, He sent me one. It was hilarious and it was a great stream. And then at the end of it, the audio didn't record. There's nothing you can do about that. You can't dub it over because it was my audio, me speaking. So it's just gone. On top of that, when I went back to the email to tell him I made that video, but unfortunately the audio didn't record, I noticed on his email he'd also done loads of work finding me loads of information, what happened next, where the bloke come from, Like, he sent me, like, a package. And the thing is, I can't record it again because it's just, you know, you can't pretend to see things for the first time again. Do you know what I mean? So I felt treble bad on that one. The problem with the Dragon's Den, if you haven't seen them, people, if you're new here, check them out. They're a great series. But the problem is, when you make a video, you want people to watch it immediately. And every single Dragon's Den gets copyright claim, and then I have to appeal, and every time you appeal, if they don't agree, you get a strike and you get a week ban. Now, I've won every appeal, but it's actually a legal appeal. It's not, there's one before an appeal. I don't know what that's called. Maybe 42 knows, I don't know. But but when you make an appeal, it's like you actually have to give them your home address and all that. And I am now in a legal battle with Sony Television. And it's a little bit scary, you know. And if you lose, you get a strike and you can't stream or make videos for a week. But I will get back to them because they were the first videos in like 10 years where I actually got some new subscribers. Right, Packer, while I am looking up something for, I'll put the link to the Tate streaming once again. While I'm looking for the outro music, what are your final thoughts?
Yeah, I don't like them. I don't mind so much what they're saying, but I don't like them.
Why don't you like them?
I don't know. Something about them. The way they're saying it, I don't like. Gloat was fairly close to how I feel about it. Mate, you said it was gloat.
Their personalities.
Yeah. Just
you know, like what they do with the women and that in their...
No, I don't know. None of how they said it and none of what they do is what I would do, but I've not got that against them. I don't hold that against them. I just don't like them particularly.
Yeah, sometimes, I mean, that's how I was, and I'm not saying you're wrong, but, you know, if you look at some of my
half-black brothers, the conservative twins or something.
I don't know, I can't stand them. Yeah, I just don't
you get see, them. I love them.
Nah,
there you go. So it's just...
They seem so low IQ to me. They're just
cutting yeah.
Like, what's he doing? And the other one goes, I don't know what he's doing. And the other one goes, why would you do that? Yeah, it's not for me. So it's a fair point. You just don't like them. Okay, that's fair enough. Poke the Bear, hello, Poke the Bear wants to know if it's because no, it's not. I've got loads of black friends. I've got a whole country full of brown friends. Right. Packer, I'll let you go, mate. Have you got any? There you go, the Hodge twins, that's it. Echo reckons that the Hodge twins are controlled opposition if ever he's seen it. This is the problem with the controlled opposition, though, because does anyone get cut a break? You know, I wouldn't be surprised if I'm still alive in a few years. Dangerfield, he's been going 15 years. That's got to be controlled opposition. Sure.
No, I'm controlled opposition.
You're not possessed by my wife. Yeah, you'll get it. Packer, thank you very much. Can we have a pee in the chat for Packer, please? That'll be
it. Can I tell you quickly, just to put this to bed before I disappear, I was going out with this really posh bird and she took me to a young farmer's ball or something.
I've got an erection just hearing you say that.
Yeah, I was kind of like trophy bit of rough or something. I'm not sure. It was a bizarre experience for I was about 18, 19. About 19, I think. There you go.
Hang on, what? That's your story?
That's where I wore the cummerbund.
Oh, my God. Oh, yeah. You forgot to say that, I think. Hang on. So did you think, oh, God, did she say, you've got to dress up? Or did you just think, I've got to dress up?
No, it was you've got to dress up. I didn't think that. It was like...
Why would she go for some gutter snipe like you and then try and turn you into one of her crowd?
I don't think she did. I think she was just showing me off.
With a cummerbund. I've never worn one. I mean, I love a cravat. I love one, but I've never... For me, they're a bit Middle Eastern. I mean, I don't know where they come from. I'd guess that they're French, maybe. Let's have a look. Let's find out. I'm sorry, it just suddenly... Where is the cummerbund from? Let's see how wrong I was. It's colonial India, the old Brits. There must have been a reason. Why would you want to wear more clothes in bloody equatorial India? Jesus. Yeah, you know what it is, yeah? Stick another 3 meters of cloth.
Part of the military uniform at one point because Lincolnshire regiment was known as the Yellow Bellies because of the colour of it.
Yeah, it says British military officers stationed in India and despite the hot temperatures wore formal uniforms and waistcoats to dinner. Would you wear what? You wear a waistcoat over a cummerbund?
Yeah, can do, yeah.
Nah, it's not for me, mate. I mean, maybe. Yeah, it was, here we go. The sepoys, the Indian soldiers. They saw them wearing them. Oh, and they decided they'd assimilate a little bit.
Appropriation.
I'll tell you what. I will say there's a couple of super chats. Have come in. I won't miss them. Thank you, Channel Entertainment. Much appreciated. There and Senna in there and says, Anne. And Chris, he says, hey, Chris and Scrubs, I'm late. Hope you're all well. Hello, Chrissy. Yeah, we're good. Well, I can't speak for everyone, but I've just realised my streaming career isn't over, so that's nice. I've done 22 hours test. And also 22 hours, thanks for doing that. Futures thing, that's a significant amount of filthy lucre, much appreciated. Hang on, Raka, what did I want to say to you before I let you go? While you're here, you ask all the girls, and you'll get this in Thailand, all the working girls, same in Thailand, same in Vietnam, same in Cambodia. You say, who's your favorite customer? European, always straight out of European. Next, Chinese. Why? Because they pay more. They just pay more. Ooh, you know, that's just a thing. And then I could get in trouble here, couldn't I? But they don't particularly like Africans out here in general. I don't know why. But they also don't particularly like Indians. But you see groups of Indian men around here, like especially up in where the ladies of easy leisure tend to apply their trade, walking around in like silver suits with like black shiny ties.
Straight out of Bollywood.
Yeah, brown loafers. But the trousers are always about 5 inches off the shoe. You know, none of them have got a pair of trousers that reach their shoe. And, you know, you can spot them a mile off, man. It's like, hang on. I know they're choosing that style, but I suppose the question is, why would you? And when I say to a lot of the girls, what is it with the Indians? They go, they not in these words, but it's pretty much, have you seen what they wear? They look, you remember the kid at school who couldn't afford any uniform whatsoever, so it was property, just like a mix.
He generally live with a relative, live with his nan or his aunt or uncle or something.
I mean, they're a really weird bunch. You know, they think having mirror glasses, you know, it's like, come on, are you really wearing mirror sunglasses? And they strike poses, they vogue, you know. When they're on the corner of the street, if one of them's at the ATM, the others are sort of like, you know, they strike poses. None of them are just sort of casually chatting. They were like, oh, it's really weird phenomena. I don't know. And they said they smell a little bit, which is weird. But it is hot out here, so everyone smells a little bit. So, yeah. Paco, I'll let you go now, mate. Thank you very much. Bless you and your family. Lots of love. Talk soon.
Cheers, Chris. Cheers, Scrubs.
Yeah. We had loads. We had the peas in the chat, didn't we? Yeah. Please don't use that fella's name again. I've had that. It makes me skittish reading Francis Foster so many times in one evening. See you later, mate. You've been brilliant. Ta-da. High five.
Oh, shit.
I love this. I've done it as well, though. He's great stuff, man. What a fine packer was. I've done all them. I did do Channel Entertainments. I did do Chris's. I did do that one. There's no new entropies. I will refresh it. Listen, I absolutely love this community. We had 180 people in for a while. I mean, it's now been 3.5 hours, so I'm not too gutted. It's gone down to 121. I really did question my channel at the end of the other stream the other day. I thought, maybe you just ain't got it anymore, son. I think I was just very tired. But tonight's been great. So I want to thank Rags and the boy Cray for looking after the place. I want to thank everyone who donated. Absolutely amazing. And obviously, I want to thank Packer because, trust me, if he's not here these days, it's very lonely. I'm just a bloke in a room. Look, this room's empty. It's just me, 5,000 miles away from home. most of all, thanks to all of you lot who come in, who engage, put comments in the chat, listen to what's being said and make it what it is. And without you lot, it's nothing. And a special hello and thank you to Mrs. Me in it, because she's one of my favourite all-time scrubs. And bless her, cotton and polyester socks. I'm going to play Paul Mumford, Cold. I can't remember what it's called. I've forgotten what it's called. Cold Blue Steel. You know the one. Anyway, this is dedicated to Anglo-Saxon and all you great scrubs. Look after yourself. Don't forget, I've got Teddy Dutton coming on to talk about There's No Free Will. I've got 42 coming on at some point to do the controlled opposition of Jordan Peterson, which we kind of touched on tonight. And always look out for streams, because if I've got a bit of time and a bit of energy, I'll usually do one. There's still time to get your grifts in, people. Here's Cold Hard Steel by Paul Mumford. Check it out. Look after yourselves. How do I get it played? Got the volume on. Here we go. I will be putting your messages on the screen for the duration of the music playing. 1 second. Plash, plash. Play.
Tell your daddy you're fighting good. Feel the glory he said you would. Tell your mama you're coming home. Over all of that deafening drone. But you'll realize you've been sold when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel. Down to your final day. Feel the fear and go anyway. Get a ride in that big black plane. Kill your conscience along your brain. But you'll realize you've been sold when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel.
Think, Glass.
The wheels already been rolled when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel. Oh, Lord.
I thought he was frightened. They're amazing.
Do whatever they tell you to. Tell yourself it ain't really you.
Nice one, Chrissy.
But when the slaughtering has begun, you'll be murdering someone's son. And you'll realize you've been sold when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel. The wheels already been rolled when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel. Oh Lord, yes, you'll realize you've been sold when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel. Oh Lord, cause the wheels already been rolled when you feel the enemy's cold heart steel. Thank you.
Swamp Pack. Hey, check this out. I've got something to show you, people. Hang on. Look at this. How weird is this? Hang on. Oh, what's going on here? How do you use computers? Stop. Start. Right. Have a look at this, people. This is a bit weird. Glass. Don't go anywhere. So, I tried to write. Oh, nice one, Jared. I missed that. I'm trying to stop drinking. Did 5 days. I'm drunk now, though. No worries. You've done 5 days. You do 5 days. You can do 6 days. If you want to stop, you know, just give it another go. There's no, you know, you don't always get things done first time, do you? And 5 days is amazing. So try six. And if you get six done, try seven. Jared, if you want to talk to me ever about that, if it's a proper problem, I'm always up for talking about people. I won't do it if you're drunk, though, just because it's not worth it, as you'll probably know. But if you want to talk about, if you need to talk to someone, I can, believe it or not, just listen. I'm always available for that on Skype or Zoom or something. Look after yourself as well. If you've got a big habit, go easy, because you can die coming off of alcohol. Don't use that as an excuse to carry on drinking, though. Sorry to hear that didn't work. But check this out, people. Look, I just tried to write something in my own stream. Look at this. Look what I got. Look at this glass. Make you laugh. Hang on. In my own stream, look what I wrote. Look at that. I just wrote glass, sink. YouTube rejected your comment. This usually means they think it's spam. Try changing it a bit. How about fuck you? What? Spamming my own fucking channel, am I? Well done, YouTube. Imagine having the biggest video hosting platform on the planet and accusing the channel owner of... They just don't want girls sinking. I'll tell you what, Susan, I don't want Susan dropping or sinking ever. Look after yourselves, people. I forgot it was the weekend. It's cheered me up so much. I haven't got to get up and work all day tomorrow, which means I can get up and probably pump some iron when I wake up in the morning. Although it looks like I've been overdoing it a little bit. What do you make of that? What do you think? What do you reckon of that? What do you reckon? I don't know. Look after yourselves, you bunch of reprobates. Hoita!